Journalists, academics, public figures, activists, human rights defenders, and many other concerned citizens are getting together to speak up against the grave human rights violations in Turkey and raise awareness as well as hope. On December 9, 10, Freedom Convention 2020 by Advocates of Silence Turkey.
Welcome everyone from all over. Sorry, I'm so excited today, everybody. Let me start. Welcome everyone from all over the world. This is the first day and the first panel of Freedom Convention 2020, whose theme is Grave Human Rights Violations in Turkey, organized by Advocates of Silence Turkey. This two-day conference, taking place on the occasion of United Nations Human Rights Day, will host 5 panel sessions in which ongoing human rights violations in Turkey will be discussed by 30 prominent experts and activists. And today we have a keynote speaker here. I would like to introduce our keynote speaker, Enes Kanter. Please join me in welcoming him. Enes Kanter is a very well-known NBA player and a strong advocate for freedom and justice. As being a concrete target of the Turkish government, his Turkish passport has been revoked and he's not been able to go to Turkey for a long time. Enes has been a voice for all those silenced and oppressed people in all the platforms he can. We are very pleased to have you today, Enes, in the very beginning of such a significant event, and it's all yours. Floor is all yours right now.
Well, thank you guys for inviting me. It's definitely an honor. Good morning, everyone. And let me express my deep honor and pleasure at being here. You know, tomorrow we will celebrate Human Rights Day and the anniversary of one of the greatest accomplishments. And, you know, it's 73 years since the declaration was adopted. Many nations have made amazing progress in making human rights a human reality. Unfortunately, today I will talk about the opposite, you know, whose human rights are still denied. They are arrested, beaten, terrorized, and even executed. You know, imagine waking up early morning and you see the news, hundreds of innocent people arrested and tortured. How would you feel? You know, it breaks my heart and it breaks your heart. This is happening every single day in Turkey. You know, I'll give you guys an example. It was Mr. Gürkan, a dedicated teacher, you know, who was arrested for supporting Akhuetem. You know, there was no evidence and no fair trial. You know, one hot summer day, he had a heart attack in an overcrowded small cell floor. You know, a few years later, the court made the decision not guilty. This is the story of hundreds of thousands of people in Turkey. You know, if you talk about me, you know, I receive deadly death threats every day. You know, they took my family as hostage, tried to punish me, and they don't want me to be the voice of the voices of people in Turkey. You know, but the Turkish government controls the media and shapes the public opinion within the Turkey, but not abroad. So this drives them crazy. You know, all the world know that the dictator of Turkey, all the world know what's going on in Turkey. And this is our responsibility to reach everyone in the free world and ask their help for the innocent people in Turkey. You know, I'm an NBA player. I have a platform. But also everyone has a platform too. So our job to try to reach as many people we can. And, you know, a lot of people are telling me that, you know, how do you stay focused on the games? How do you go out there and play basketball? You know, my answer is really simple. I think about the political prisoners in cells. I think about the hundreds of babies in prison. I think about the tortured people and suffer people around the world, you know, in the Turkish jails. And this gives me an extra motivation to go out there and play extra hard. You know, lastly, I just wanna say I'm really, really proud of the Advocates of Silence, the Turkey organization. You know, they have been doing an amazing job raising awareness about the human rights violations in Turkey and advocating for the rights of persecuted people. You know, you look at Turkey right now, more than 150,000 people, you know, public workers, including generals, admirals, judges, prosecutors, doctors, you know, teachers, police officers have been summarily sacked by emergency decrees without the process, leading to human rights violation against, you know, hundreds of thousands of people. So let's continue our activism until the last political prisoner released from the prison. And I'm asking everyone who's watching this right now to double their efforts. And trust me, we will be in the right part of the history. And thank you, guys.
Thank you, Enes. We know that it's very early there in Portland, and thank you for joining us today. And good luck with your new team, too. Keep up the good work. We appreciate
it. I'm really excited.
We appreciate what you're doing for human rights. Thank you.
Thank you.
And now we would like to share with you a special letter, a very special letter from the Congressperson Alcy Hastings. He's also the chairman of U.S. Helsinki Commission. He just prepared a very good, beautiful letter for us today, and I'm going to share it with you, his message.
And now our opening message from Alcy L. Hastings, United States Congressman and Chairman of the United States Helsinki Commission, Commission on Security and Cooperation in Europe. Dear friends, I am honored by your invitation to speak at the Freedom Convention 2020, and I am sorry that I cannot be with you for this important event. Your tireless advocacy and work for human rights is crucial to those living in the Republic of Turkey and human rights efforts globally. I commend the work that the Advocates of Silence Turkey is doing to establish universal human rights and democratic governance within the Republic of Turkey. This year's convention topic, Turkey, Grave Human Rights Violations, highlights the dire need to champion efforts to establish democratic governance and respect for human rights. Since July of 2016, the Turkish government has improperly imprisoned 130,214 homemakers, teachers, those employed at non-governmental organizations, academics, judges, prosecutors, and journalists. As a dedicated advocate for the establishment of human rights around the world, I will continue to do my part in this fight for those in the Republic of Turkey who wish to realize a Turkish Republic that once again values the rule of law and human rights. Once more, please accept my best wishes and appreciation for all that you do to work towards establishing democratic practices and respect for human rights in Turkey. I wish you nothing but success with your convention, and I look forward to working with all of you to continue in this shared endeavor. With warm personal regards, I remain, sincerely, Alcy L. Hastings, Member of Congress.
Yeah. So we have great panelists today with us. Mr. Gergerlioğlu, Mr. Ömer Faruk Gergerlioğlu from Turkey, MP, Member of Parliament of the People's Democratic Party, and Professor Eugene Charnowski, Arzu Yıldız, a very prominent journalist, Abdülhamit Bilici, again an exile journalist, Ahmet Nesin, a journalist too, and Mr. Hakan Yeşilova. We will start off with Mr. Ömer Faruk Gergerlioğlu. And our first panelist is Dr. Ömer Faruk Gergerlioğlu, and he, as a pulmonologist, was purged from public service in 2017, along with hundreds of thousands of other public servants. Since then, and even before that, he has been fighting for human rights and speaking out against oppression and injustice as an activist, as well as a parliament member. Dr. Gergerlioğlu, thank you for joining us in this event. Welcome. We are all ears to you. And I would like to mention that Mr. Gergerlioğlu will speak English, and Mr. Saymaz, our great translator today, will translate him into English. Yes, Mr. Gergerlioğlu.
Evet. Değerli arkadaşlar, herkesi selamlıyorum. Merhaba diyorum. Değerli katılımcılara, panelistlere saygılarımı, sevgilerimi sunuyorum ve bizi izleyen saygılarımı sunuyorum.
Okay.
Öncelikle insan hakları gününe yaklaşıyoruz. Evet, yarın insan hakları günü ve önümüzdeki hafta insan hakları haftası. Hem Türkiye'de hem dünyanın dört bir tarafında insan hakları etkinlikleri yapılacak. Ama biz ülkemiz için, Türkiye için çok iyi şeyler söyleyemeyeceğiz maalesef. Maalesef insan hakları alanında iyiye giden bir yer değil. Ben ifade özgürlüğü ve Türkiye'nin manzarasını anlatmak isterim.
Bir dakika. Bunu bu arada birkaç saniyenizi rica edeceğim. So first and foremost, I would like to welcome everyone who's watching this event and also all these people attending. As we all know, we are approaching the day of human rights, and you know, I would like to talk about a little bit. Biraz kısa şeyler halinde verebilirsek daha accurate tamam. Olabilir.
Tamam. İfade özgürlüğü insan olmanın en büyük özelliğidir. İnsanoğlu dünyaya iz bıraktığı günlerden itibaren bir şekilde kendisini ifade etmeye çalışmış, mağaralara şekiller çizmiş ve daha değişik izler bırakmış. Belki işin doğrusu ifade özgürlüğünün en özgür olduğu zamanlar o zamanlar olmuş ve bir toplumsallaşma ve devletleşme hadisesi başladığı zaman yasaklar gelmeye başlamış ve bunun belki ifadeye baskıların getirilmesinin zararını ilk başta anlayamayanlar daha sonra müstebit iktidarlar eliyle ilk önce ifadeye yasak getirildiği ve daha sonra da hayata, mala kastedildiğini büyük bir üzüntüyle görmüşlerdir.
The freedom of expression is the biggest characteristic of human being human. Since mankind started living its mark on its earth, it was trying to express itself. Those days maybe had the biggest freedom of express. As man drew his daily life on the cave walls, he also drew his hopes, dreams, and goals. In the time, communal life began, and maybe the first prohibitions to expression began as well. It may have been the first time when opposing voices began to be silenced. Expressions were prohibited first, but the pain brought by these prohibitions was eventually revealed. The price of obeying pressure on expression proved to be higher, bringing about loss of life and property, battles, wars, and massacres.
Evet, tarihi biliyoruz. Aslında medeniyetlerin gelişimi, ifade özgürlüğünün gelişimiyle doğru orantılıdır. Bunu çok iyi görüyoruz. Ama devletler, iktidarlar ifade özgürlüğünden pek haz etmemiştir ve engellemeye çalışmıştır. İşte binlerce yıllık insanlık tarihinde bunları çok yakinen biliriz. Galilei'yi biliriz, diğer bir bilim insanlarını biliriz ve bu konudaki gerçekten insanlığın gelişimine yardımcı olan büyük bilim insanlarının çok fedakar gayretlerini görürüz ve ifadenin sonunda gelişmeye başladığını, ifadenin gelişmesiyle medeniyetin ve bilimin, tekniğin gelişmeye başladığını görürüz. Ve bunların sonunda ister istemez çekişmeler, çatışmalar olmuştur. Dünya üzerinde ifade özgürlüğünün gelişmesini istemeyen güçler baskıcılıklarını devam ettirmişler ve ardından savaşlar, yıkımlar olmuş ve bundan en fazla dünyadaki insanlar zarar görmüştür ve Türkiye'de aynı şekilde Osmanlı İmparatorluğu zamanındaki ifadeye getirilen yasaklamaları maalesef devam ettirmiş ve Cumhuriyet'in 100 yıla yaklaşan zamanında ifade özgürlüğü konusunda çok büyük sıkıntılar olduğunu yakinen biliyoruz.
So the freedom expression was what enhance the human, but communities that stated had no intention of letting that happen. Ruling powers did not want the people to stray outside of the borders they drew and shot themselves in the foot by doing so. Why was it wrong? Because they actually shot the betterment of humanity instead of decay within them. This persistent attitude filed the history of science and politics with the most striking negative examples of freedom of expression. That was because they didn't want freedom lovers and political religious leaders have free reign to oppose the oppressive regimes. For those opposers who fought science and thought reached their end, there were no avenue for few proposals, projects, or alternatives.
Türkiye'de müstebit iktidar okları gösterdi ve insanların nasıl düşünmesi, nasıl olması gerektiğini dikte etmeye çalıştı. Bunu herkese yaptı ve işte azınlıklar kendilerini ifade eden aciz kaldılar çünkü büyük baskı altındaydılar. Aleviler yine aynı şekilde baskı altındaydılar. Evlerinin kapılarına sık sık çarpı işareti vuruluyordu. Kürtler baskı altındaydı, Ermeniler, bunlar baskı altındaydı. Ülkenin çoğunluğunu oluşturan Sünni dindarlar da baskı altındaydı aslında. Görüntü devletin dini şeklindeydi. Devletin dini vardı ortada. Sünni dindarlar da dinlerini yaşamakla ilgili büyük sıkıntılar yaşadılar. Başörtüsü sorunları, efendim, dini ilimler tahsil etme anlamında büyük sıkıntılar yaşadılar. Yine ateistin de sıkıntı yaşadığı bir yer oldu. Çünkü o da inanmadığını söyleyemedi. Velhasılı kelam, sıkıntı yaşamayan kalmadı. Yani A'dan Z'ye bir elbise giydirilmeye çalışılan toplumun her ferdi bu sıkıntıları tattı ve bu dairelerin dışına çıkılmaması için yasalar oluşturuldu. İşte eskiden hatırlıyoruz 141'ler, 142'ler, 163'ler. Peki onlar kaldırıldı ne oldu? 301'ler getirildi, 314'ler getirildi, TMK 7/2'ler getirildi. Hiçbir zaman için kendini ifade etmeye çalışanları rahat bırakmadı. Aslında hani tek parti dönemleri, darbeler, muhtıralar bunlar sonrasında hani böyle ya ne yaptık biz? Oturalım, konuşalım dendiği zamanlarda toplumun çok rahatladığı görüldü. Hani işte bir takım tartışma programları olurdu televizyonlarda. Böyle televizyonların artık devlet kanalından kurtulması, özel kanalların çıkmasıyla serbest tartışma programlarının çıkması ve bu programların inanılmaz popülerite kazanması aslında Türkiye toplumunun ifade özgürlüğüne ne kadar aç olduğunu gösteriyor. Hani hiç unutmayız ve Türkiye'deki çok kişi bilir. Ali Kırca'nın önemli bir programı vardı. Siyaset Meydanı diye. Sabahlara kadar insanlar konuşurdu. İşte akşam 9-10'da başlardı. Saat 4-5-6'ya kadar insanlar konuşurdu. Ve hiç kimse de uyumazdı, bıkmazdı, usanmazdı. Demek ki çok büyük bir açlık vardı Türkiye'de.
So, it is important to discuss where the countries of the world in terms of freedom of expression, but it's even more important to discuss Turkey, where we see saddest examples of this matter despite the allegations on the contrary. Turkey is a country where in a country which met the democracy later in history. The Ottoman Empire had entered a decline due to its failure in field of freedom of expression, went through all cross-border traumas. The newly founded Republic of Turkey also found freedom of expression a threat in order to hold on to what they had remaining. Their elites thought the community and the system should be created from scratch and shaped. The road ahead was pointed with arrows and was tried to be reshaped. Shortly, an unhappy community emerged because of all those left outside the circle. There was an environment where Muslims couldn't say Allah, Christians couldn't say couldn't announce their beliefs, Alawis, and feared of their lives. When they declared their sect, and Kurds were scorned using their mother tongue, and also the atheists, had difficulty. They couldn't even mention that they were not believers, and even the Sunnis, they could not live the lives they wanted to live from A to Z. Government tried to shape them, put them in the same dress, and told them actually not to get out of that circle. By previously there was the laws numbered 141, 143, 163. So these wars, the laws actually changed, and they were out the window. And then they brought in 301s, 304s, TMK 7/2. So what changed? So from having from a one party regime to military coups, what really changed actually? So if you recall, there was this TV series, it's this political, square, it's called. It was led by the host, Ali Kurja. It started around like 9 p.m. in the evening, and it went ahead actually until 3 or 4 in the morning. And people were glued to the TV because they were, actually hungry to listen, these talk shows, and they were hungry because of freedom of expression. Contrary to what was feared, freedom of expression could have formed more relief than developing society, but authorities were concerned about that. Laws were created to silence all concerning factions, and this tradition endured. Up and coming to power, everybody thought they owned the government and made life hell for everyone, and they thought that was a threat to them. There actually were examples of civil disclosure and tolerance to opposing views. In some rare periods, there were instances people are listening to one another. So, go ahead. Devam edebilirsiniz.
Evet, AK Partili yıllara geldiğimiz zaman bir toplumsal konsensüs oluşmuştu ve yılların darbe sonrası dönemlerinin baskılarından sonra iktidar demokratikleşme, özgürlük adımları atmaya başlamıştı ve bu konuda AB'ye uyum süreci şu bu denilirken AK Parti'de olmayan çok kişi de evet yani ülkede özgürlük, insan hakları alanında bir şeyler yapılacaksa biz de engel olmayalım bakış açısıyla bu gelişmelere iyi gözle baktı ama ardından Erdoğan'ın oldukça hevesli bir iktidar hırsı yüzünden bu süreç de yıkıldı ve ilk başta muhaliflerini aşağılayan, daha sonraki süreçte de kendi ilk yol arkadaşlarını dışlayan Erdoğan iktidarı tamamen baskıcı bir yola girdi. Bu arada Kürt meselesinin çözümü konusunda bu demokratikleşme zamanında adımlar atıldı ama Erdoğan'ın bu kendisini merkeze oturtan egosantrik tavrı yüzünden bütün bu süreçlerde yıkıldı ve sonrasında Türkiye iyice antidemokratik, hukuka aykırı bir sürece girdi. 15 Temmuz darbe girişimi, çözüm sürecinin bitmesi, Türkiye'de demokrasi hukuk yanları açısından bir cehennem ortamı oluşturdu ve son 5 yıldır Türkiye gerçekten yani bu 100 yıllık Türkiye Cumhuriyeti tarihinin sanırım hem sağdan hem soldan her kesiminin ittifak ettiği şekilde en kötü yıllarını yaşıyor. Binlerce kadının cezaevlerinde olduğu, düşünce insanlarının cezaevlerinde olduğu veya yurt dışına kaçma zorunda olduğu, 60 bine yakın insanın, çok nitelikli insanın yurt dışına çıkmak zorunda olduğunu biliyoruz. Ve binlerce akademisyenin ihraç edildiği, sırf Erdoğan'ın tersine farklı fikirler düşündükleri için ihraç edildikleri ve ölüme mahkum edildikleri, o hal KHK'larıyla yüz binlerce insanın perişan edildiği, vatandaşlıktan çıkarıldığı, sivil ölüme uğratıldığı acımasız bir döneme girdik. Adeta bir kırım ve tasfiye yaşatılıyordu. Bu dönemin önemli rakamları var. 600 bin soruşturma, 300 bin gözaltı ve 100 bin tutuklama sayıları nüfusa da oranlandığı zaman gerçekten çok vahim sayılar ve adaletin ortadan kalktığı bu dönemde hızla cezaevleri doldu ve gençler babası veya annesinin siyasi görüşünden dolayı sosyal medyadan çekildi. Kimse sosyal medyada görüşlerini artık ifade edemiyor.
So in the last 5 years, Turkey is facing the biggest restrictions on the freedom of expression, which has already had a severe restrictions to begin with. We became a country where people's homes are raided by government police in the early hours of the morning due to their thoughts, and their doors are broken, people detained while their children look with fear in their eyes, then they've been treated badly, tortured. Records were broken in the last 5 years, especially in comparison to the entire Turkish Republic's history, which was 100 years. This was the worst of the worst 5 years. What I mean is the last 5 years clearly displayed a peak due to 600,000 investigations, 300,000 detainments, and 100,000 arrests. The country where a person of person's criticism of the government made years ago on social media make it acceptable for that person to be subjected to degrading behavior, which gave birth to an introvert society, desperate youth. So if we were to look actually Erdogan's, the desire to actually hold on to the reins of the power, which actually destroyed the freedoms, and the way that he had treated his oppositions. And so at one point, they tend to work on the Kurdish problem in the country, but because he's an egocentric person, that also destroyed that as well. And especially the period after July 15th, the coup attempt. About 60,000 people had to unfortunately flee the country, and about over thousands of actual academicians actually they left to starve or die because of with the country's decree laws and state of emergency laws, so it was in a way we could call a civilian death, left the at this point we were faced with a sudden peak of hundreds of thousands of people again arrestees, a scared community, again community depending of the ruling party for its interest. We lead the world in women filling prisons with their babies in the thousands.
Bak, ifade özgürlüğüyle ilgili üzücü binlerce örnek verilebilir ama ben vakit kısa. 3 tane örnekle konuşmamı bitireyim. Şu anda bir siyasetçiyim, uzun yıllardır insan hakları savunucusuyum. Birinci örnek siyaset alanından. Genel Başkanımız Pervin Buldan'ı sadece dinlediğim için fezleke almış, yani soruşturma istenerek dokunulmazlığımın kaldırılmasının istendiği bir milletvekili. Komik bir şey ama anlatayım. Hani çok fazla örneği anlatmadan bu üç örnekle sanırım Türkiye ifade özgürlüğünü anlatmış olurum. Bir toplantıda genel başkanımızı dinlediğim için, hani tek bir kelime konuşmuyorum düşünün. Sadece dinlediğim için İşte söylenenlere niye muhalefet etmedin ve muhalefet etmeyerek terör örgütü propagandasına eşlik ettin diyerek terör örgütü propagandası yaptığım yolunda bir fezleke düzenledim. Sadece bir konuşmayı dinlediğim, tek bir kelime sarf etmediğim var. İkinci örnek, Türkiye'de Covid vakaları ortaya çıktığında Covid vakalarının bildirilmesi çok engelleniyordu ve biz de mahpus hastaları hastanelerdeki bilgileriyle kamuoyuna yansıttığımız için hakkımızda yine fezleke düzenlendi. Bari sen nasıl vakaları bildirirsin dendi. Ve daha sonra bu bildirdiğim vaka da COVID tedavisi altında hayatını kaybetti. Üçüncü olarak yine ifade özgürlüğünün ne durumda olduğuna dair sanırım başka bir örneğe gerek bırakmayacak çarpıcı bir örnek. Türkiye'nin şu anda Anayasa Mahkemesi Başkanı olan Zühtü Arslan, Profesör Zühtü Arslan'ın yazarları arasında olduğu ve Türkiye'nin dünyanın en saygın insan hakları hukukçularının makaleler verdiği İfade Özgürlüğü kitabı Diyarbakır cezaevine alınmadı. Gerekçe ise bir yargı kararı değil, oradaki cezaevi müdürünün ben bu kitapta terör örgütünün propagandasının yapıldığını düşünüyorum. Düşünüyorum yani bu kadar. O yüzden bu kitabın alınması uygun değildir denmesi. Daha sonra infaz hakimliğinin de bunu uygun bulması ve böylece ifade özgürlüğü kitabının Diyarbakır cezaevine girememesi. Daha artık ben değerli misafirlere, izleyenlere ifade özgürlüğüyle ilgili daha ne anlatayım değerli arkadaşlar? Sanırım bu üç örnek Türkiye'de ifade özgürlüğünün ne durumda olduğunu anlatır. Gerisi artık fazla bir konuşma olur diye düşünüyorum. Konuşmamı burada bitiriyorum. Teşekkür ederim.
So I can give thousands of examples to display the condition, the dire condition of freedom of expression in Turkey, but there wouldn't be enough time. We're given only so much time to speak here. I'll give some examples, of these things happened to me and to those, I've heard, I'll give like three examples of those. There's been, for example, there was an inquiry, an investigation on me in the Grand National Assembly, even though I was listening to the speech or a speech on our party chairperson without talking. So I was just listening to that conversation and the speech of the chairperson. The inquiry, the investigation, they had started, asked and tried upon me, alleging that I participated in the propaganda of a terrorist organization by staying silent during the speech of the chairperson. So I think no explanation on the appealing condition of the freedom of expression are necessary. Consider the situation of the country where you are blamed for a propaganda of a Congress person, even if you have expressed nothing. You just sat there and listened. Another inquiry and investigation against me issued by the Ankara's chief public prosecutor was due to informing the public about the hospitalization of a sick person, ill person due to COVID-19. The investigation later on was not recalled by the authorities, who gave no statement on the person who died eventually of COVID-19. I got indicted by the prosecutor for inventing crimes, but several journalists shared the same fates as me. Because the government had been feeding the public with lies since the beginning of the pandemic and was very sensitive about the truth coming out. Another striking example in the fact that a book prepared by several prestigious authors was not allowed inside the Diyarbakir prison. The book, Freedom of Expression, written by several reputable scientists and human rights lawyers, including Zühtü Arslan, a president of a constitutional court, had the correct stamp making its sale legal. So it had a stamp, it was legal to sell this book in Turkey, was not allowed in Diyarbakir prison during the state of emergency. This ban, of which I learned from an application made to me by inmates, is justified by something even more unbelievable and shown the state of freedom of expression. The prison warden had taken the decision based on the administrative justification that an esteemed book was making propaganda for a terrorist organization. This was striking example by an administration acting as judiciary. As a congressperson with judicial immunity, I was subjected to battery by the police at several press briefings. This was the experience of myself, of several other Congress people, because what they feared most was expressing being free. Words can't describe this period in which we experienced the worst examples of the state of freedom, of expression and press. We can only be free from the oppression through embracing our expressions even harder and making them even stronger.
Thank you, Dr. Gergerlioğlu. I'm reading the comments on YouTube while I was reading when you were speaking, and there is a huge crowd out there praying for you, chanting for you, for your bravery, for your support of the human rights. I have a question, a very brief question. You pictured a very dismal Turkey in terms of human rights violations. How do you project Turkey in the short run in terms of freedom of expression?
Bir daha alabilir miyim? Affedersiniz, bir daha alabilir misin?
Sure. I was asking, I was just saying that on YouTube, in the comments part, people were just chanting and praying for him, for his bravery, for his support. And my question is that he pictured a very dismal Turkey in terms of human rights. How can you project Turkey in the short run in terms of freedom of expression?
Öncelikle bu özellikle YouTube'da katılımcıların büyük bir desteğine şahit oluyoruz ve alkışına diyebiliriz. Şunu sorabilir miyiz? Önümüzdeki kısa süreç içerisinde Türkiye için ifade özgürlüğü ile ilgili neler düşünüyorsunuz? İfade özgürlüğünün geleceği diyelim.
Mücadeleyle alakalı. Bizim mücadele etmemiz lazım. Siyasetçilerin, insan hakları savunucularının, eli kalem tutanların, bir davası olanların, bu ülkenin daha iyi olması için gayret sarf edenlerin, herkesin gayreti ölçüsünde olacak. Büyük mücadelelerle kazanılacak. Nasıl ki dünyanın başka ülkelerinde ifade özgürlüğü mücadeleleri çok büyük gayretlerle, yorgunluklarla, bedellerle kazanılmışsa, Türkiye'de de böyle olacak. Türkiye açıkçası demokrasiyi hazmetmiş bir ülke olarak demokrasinin uygulandığı bir ülke haline gelmedi. Hani böyle biraz tepeden inme bir şekilde Türkiye'ye demokrasi geldi ve işte bir takım kurumlar kuruldu. Alın size demokrasiyi uygulayın dendi. Ama toplum bunu içselleştirmemişti. Eski binlerce yıllık geleneksel tortular duruyordu. Hem siyasal hem dini açıdan, birçok açıdan insanlar yüzleşmemişti kendileriyle, toplumla, düşüncelerle ve gelenekle yüzleşmemişlerdi. Ve demokratik bir yönetim olduğu söyleniyordu, iddia ediliyordu. İşin doğrusu adeta bir kayaya çarptık. İfade özgürlüğü isteyenler için böyle oldu. Kayaya çarptık ve ifade özgürlüğünün öyle tepeden inme bir şekilde, demokrasinin tepeden inme bir şekilde olamayacağını, aslında bunun büyük mücadelelerle kazanılabileceğini ve bu yaşadıklarımızın çok garip olmadığını, toplumun demokrasiyi içselleştirmediği, özgürlüğü, hakkı, hukuku içselleştirmediği, bir başkasının hakkını içselleştirmediği, insan haklarını içselleştirmediği bir müddet içinde bizim ilerleyemeyeceğimiz görülüyor. Ama biz eğer ki tüm mağdurlar, son olarak şunu söyleyeyim, biz eğer ki her kesimden farklı ifade özgürlüğü mağdurları, insan hakları ortak paydasında bir diğerimizin özgürlüğüne saygı duyarsak, amasız bir ifade özgürlüğü istersek, sanırım meseleyi halledebileceğiz. Asıl önemli ilerlemeler o zaman olacak. Yoksa kendine Müslüman, kendine demokrat bir anlayış içinde olduğumuz müddetçe istediği kadar bizim mağduriyetlerimiz giderilsin, bir anlamı yoktur. Ortak bir şekilde farklı kesimlerin bir insan hakları ortak platformunda gayret etmesi sanırım ihlalleri bitirecek en önemli gayrettir.
So first and foremost, So we struggle. I want to say that struggle. We, you know, for those who has were able and capable of putting up the struggle and opposition, that would be great. For those who can hold a pen, so that means a writer, whether or anyone who's capable. You know, we have to oppose. We have to be stay strong and struggle against this oppression. So, you know, if you were to look at the democracy, democracy was handed down upon us. It was just pretty much what dropped on our lap. It was not, you know, and they put together, you know, a few institutions and they gave us this system, democracy, and said, there you go. So it was not the fact that people, I might say that actually, have not digested it. Yes, they did not totally, completely, comprehensively understood the process and the meaning of you know, democracy. So in that sense, we have to continue to you know, struggle to understand this. Well, first and foremost, you know, we have to understand and respect each other's rights. So, you know, you could be a Muslim, a Democrat, but, you know, there has to be a common ground where we can meet. And it will not start just from the institution. It has to start from the people. The very people, I believe, the reason the democracy wasn't completely worked out, because the people did not totally observe and digest and understand and live the democracy. It has to start from like the people. We have to respect each other.
Thank you, Dr. Gergerlioğlu. Your remarks are really important in terms of not looking at the identity of the, you know, victim, but fighting for the human rights of everyone, regardless of their beliefs, ideologies, whatever. And I know that you have a session in the parliament. You have to leave. Thank you a lot for joining us. And I can still see the comments, praise, and applauses for you. Thank you for what you have been doing. You're our hero in our hearts, in our prayers. Thank you so much.
Çok teşekkürler efendim. Bu yorumlardan da görüyoruz. İnsanlar sizleri tebrik ediyorlar, alkışlıyorlar. Bunu söyleyebilirim. Biliyoruz ki parlamentoda geri dönmeniz gerekiyor. Orada da işleriniz var. Şunları bilmek istiyoruz ki size olan muhabbetimiz büyük. Siz bizim kalplerimizde kahramanımsınız. Çok teşekkürler katılmanız için.
Çok teşekkür ederim. Herkese selamlar. İnşallah hep birlikte başaracağız.
Okay. Thank you very much for having me and God bless you.
And our second speaker is in this panel is Eugene, Professor Eugene Michael Chernovsky, a distinguished professor of physics at Herbert Lehman College of the CUNY, State University of New York. Professor Chernovsky, like today's other panelists, experienced persecution when he was in Russia. Having obtained his undergrad, grad, and postdoctoral education at Kharkiv University, yes, great, in Ukraine, and being denied his right to employment and travel, he was exposed to harassment by KGB. After many years of persecution, he could manage to migrate to the United States, and since then, he has been an active advocate of human rights through his position in several organizations. And today he joined us as a representative of the Committee of Concerned Scientists, where he is the co-chair. Professor Chernovsky, thank you for being among us today and welcome. The floor is yours.
Thank you. Good morning or good evening, wherever you are. I will speak on behalf of the Committee of Concerned Scientists that I co-chair. And before that, I chaired Human Rights Committee of the New York Academy of Sciences. And before that, I chaired Human Rights Committee of the American Physical Society. And before that, at Hafsa said, I was in Russia doing similar things. So I have some experience of what is going on in different countries with respect to human rights violations, and in Turkey in particular. Years ago, when I served on various human rights committees, we worked on the case of Ergenekon, but now it's a totally different situation. The Committee of Concerned Scientists is 50 years old, and its mission is to defend scholars, scientists, engineers who are harassed by their governments in various countries throughout the world, including the United States. And here you can see on my slide cases that we considered, actually some of them, during the last 4 years, from 2016 to 2020, many countries are there, but I would like to mention here the countries where we believe the violation of human rights of scientists and scholars are the most egregious. It is Iran by severity of sentences. It is Turkey by pure numbers, and few examples will follow. And it is China through internment of Uyghur scholars. We have thousands of cases documented in Turkey, but of course I don't have time to speak about them. And I will pick just a few cases that I'm going to mention. May know that 5 years ago, Turkey used tanks and helicopters to suppress Kurdish insurgencies in the southeast. And the observer, who is known to the Committee of Concerned Scientists, wrote that the scale of the losses and destruction suffered by the population could only be comprehended as a collective punitive operation against the inhabitants, and that it has no place in the modern legal system. And she also cited local newspaper, and when I read the piece from that newspaper, I was absolutely horrified. They described the case of a 14-year-old boy who had gone out to fetch water from the nearby quarter, and based upon eyewitness accounts, he was shot in the chest and fell, and he raised his hand to signal he was still alive, and then they shot him in the hand. Then one officer walked up to him and shot him in the head. And you are horrified when you read things like that. At the time when I read it, I had a 14-year-old in my house. No one can imagine, it's unimaginable to think that it can happen to your child. And due to all these events, in January of 2016, over 2,000 scholars, over 1,000 of them from Turkey, signed the petition, "We will not be a party to this crime." It was drafted by Turkish Academics for Peace, a group that was advocating for a peace solution of the Kurdish issue since 2012. Over 600 of them have been put on trial. More than 140 have been sentenced to prison terms, ranging from 15 to 36 months. Here on the left, you see a picture of Dr. Sebnem Karur Financi of the Institute of Forensic Medicine. He is president of Turkish Human Rights Foundation, very well known to the United Nations for her work on war crime tribunal in Bosnia some period of time. And then under her picture, you see a picture of a very prominent physicist, Ayşe Erzan, recipient of the L'Oréal UNESCO Award for Women in Science and the European Ramal Award. She was sentenced to 15 months in prison. In July of last year, Turkish Constitutional Court ruled that sentences given to Academics for Peace who protested massacre of Kurdish civilians by the army violated their freedom of expression. And the court ruled that each of the accused be paid 9,000 Turkish lira in damages. In October 2019, Ayşe Erzan was awarded Andrei Sakharov Prize. This is just a tip of the iceberg that I'm mentioning about Academic for Peace. Now, another case is the case of a Turkish-American citizen, Serkan Golge, who was arrested on a family visit in the Hatay province of Turkey in summer 2016. And then for a long time, he was in prison without a trial. Then finally, there was the first court hearing in 2017. And he was accused of membership in the organization of Fethullah Gulen and of spying for the CIA. And the material evidence of his crimes, and I'm sure that many of you know this, included his teenage studies at the Test Preparation Center and Fatih University in Istanbul. Now it is closed, allegedly affiliated with Gulen, and also his account in Asia Bank, also closed, that was popular with Gulen supporters, allegedly. And the most ridiculous accusation was that the serial number of a $1 bill found in Golgi's possession at the time of his arrest was interpreted as his place in the hierarchy of Gulen's organization. He, of course, denied all charges. There were more hearings, and eventually he was sentenced to 7.5 years in prison. It was commuted to 5 years in September 2018. When he was in prison, he developed kidney stones, was hospitalized for 3 days. A request by his attorney to release him on bail was denied. And his attorney revealed that interrogators repeatedly asked Golgi whether he would be willing to return to the United States as a spy for Turkey in exchange for his freedom. He came to the United States in 2003, attended a graduate program at Old Dominion University in Norfolk, then did his doctoral and postdoctoral studies at famous Thomas Jefferson National Accelerator Facility, became American citizen in 2010. And from 2013, he worked as a senior scientist at the University of Houston. He did research for NASA at Johnson Space Center. His research was devoted to safety of travel, long time travel in space. He married his sweetheart, Kubra, who came to the United States from Turkey to study English. They bought a house, they had cars, they lived as all American citizens do. They lost all of it when he was in prison. But fortunately, he was released in May of 2019 following a phone conversation between Trump and Erdogan. For more than a year, he was kept under house arrest, and he was finally allowed to return to the United States in July of this year. Last time I spoke with him, he said that the family was doing great and NASA was giving him his job back. And my last slide here is about a mathematics professor at France, Claude Bernard, Lyon 1 University, Tuna Altinel. In February 2019, he attended a meeting in Lyon, amid Cœur de Lyon, French organization that raises awareness of the plight of Kurds. And at that meeting, the film was projected, and a Turkish politician who is a member of the Turkish People's Democratic Party gave a talk. He was present there and he was translating things, you know, to some people who didn't understand Turkish. Then in April 2019, he traveled to Turkey for holidays. He has family there. And on his entry, his passport was confiscated. Then in May, he came to the police to inquire about his passport. At that moment, he was arrested, accused of propagandizing for a terrorist organization. He lived and worked in France since 1996. This is 24 years. His arrest ignited many protests from mathematicians, human rights organizations all over the world. In July 2019, he was finally released from prison. And in January, he was acquitted by the court of all charges. However, he cannot go back to his teaching in France because authorities in Balikesir denied his request to reissue his passport. And then he cannot go back to his job, but he is not the only one. There are many thousands of people like him in Turkey. Despite the decision in 2019 of the Constitutional Court, cases of many academics for peace and other scientists, engineers who were accused of cooperation with Gulen organization, they are still held by the lower courts and they were not reinstated in their positions. And there are thousands of scholars now in Turkey who continue to live under enormous psychological and financial pressure. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Chernovsky. If you could please stop sharing your screen, everybody can see you more closely. Great, great. So your remark as an academic and who experienced persecution and exile showed how, not only the extent of the brain drain in Turkey, but how the academics in exile are still facing the consequences of the the lack of the freedom of speech and the oppression. So how do you think the young generation in Turkey will face consequences of oppression and crackdown on the academia in Turkey?
I have traveled to Turkey many times, and I've spoken to a young generation of people in Turkey and outside Turkey. And I don't see any difference between a position of human rights defenders that I know on the Committee of Concerned Scientists and other human rights organizations and young people in Turkey. And given that, I have no doubt that changes are coming to Turkey, but how long it will take? Because people in the 50s, prominent scholars, professors who were fired, they probably cannot, wait another 10 years or, 15 years to get reinstated and go back to their career. So this is a horrible situation right now.
Yes. Thank you so much, Professor Chudnovsky. Thank you for joining us today. And I know that you have been doing great work on the human rights, not only for people here, for people all around the world, for people in Turkey. Thank you for all of this. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you for inviting me.
Of course. And now we are going on this great panel with Arzu Yıldız. Arzu, my friend, is an exile journalist who had to flee Turkey after hundreds of critical journalists were targeted by the Turkish government following the 2016 coup attempt. And as an outspoken journalist, both back in Turkey and now in Canada, Arzu Yıldız is the recipient of the Media Ethics Award and the Bravest Woman Award. One of the most significant cases against her was because of a report she wrote on the search of drugs, as you may all know, allegedly belonging to MIT, the Turkish intelligence service. And they were again allegedly transferring weapons to Syria. Arzu is living in Canada right now with her two daughters from whom she had to separate while fleeing Turkey and still actively speaking against injustice and human rights violations taking place in Turkey and writing real life stories as a freelance journalist and author. Arzu, could you please tell us about your own study as a Perth journalist, as a mother and as an outspoken woman? And I want to again mention that Arzu will be speaking Turkish and then our great translator will be translating her words.
Aslında ben kendimi tanıtarak başlayacaktım ama sen her şeyi söyledin. 4 sene işte Türkiye'de 4 sene öncesine kadar Türkiye'de gazetecilik yapıyordum. Normal yani bir hayatım vardı. Türkiye dışında birçok ülkeyi görmüştüm fakat yurt dışında yaşamayı düşünmüyordum. Tabii 15 Temmuz sonrası hayatım birden değişti. Ama şöyle söyleyebilirim, Türkiye'deki hukuksuzluk 15 Temmuz'la başlamadı. Onun çok öncesinde vardı. Ben Taraf Gazetesi'nde çalıştım. Farklı medya kurumlarında bağımsız gazetecilik yaptım. O dönemde işte Deniz Fener'in yolsuzluğu, faili meçhul cinayetlerle ilgili soruşturmalar vardı. Bunları takip ettim. Burada keseyim istersen şey çeviri yapılsın devam edelim.
So I wanted to talk about myself a little bit, but what she has already mentioned quite a bit of it. So I've been here for about 4 years, but again I used to live in Turkey. I was born and grown up there. until, you know, for like 36 years. You know, I've been to a lot of countries in the world, but I never thought of, didn't have any plans to live in another country. I worked as a journalist. I worked in the, you know, the newspaper of Taraf, or, and also, you know, worked as an independent news, a journalist for many media outlets. And I cannot say that, you know, I've obtained the material of benefit from this job, but I can't even say that. So I worked, I used to make news from courthouses. I witnessed several dramas with my own eyes rather than reading them in newspaper headlines. I felt like I lived them. Go ahead, devam ediniz.
Tabii ilk aslında hukuku inkar etme 17 Aralık yolsuzluk soruşturmasıyla başladı. Çünkü orada iktidara yönelik bir suç vardı. Hükümetin, bakanlarının da adının karıştığı. Orada suçun, yani suçsuzluğun ispatı ve hukuka ifade verme yerine polisleri görevden aldılar. Ondan 17 Aralık'tan böyle bir ay kadar sürmeden 1 ve 19 Ocak'ta Adana'da silah yüklü tırlar durduruldu. Orada savcılar görevden alındı ve bu savcılar tutuklandı. Daha sonra o polisler tutuklandı. Akabinde Taraf Gazetesi muhabiri Mehmet Baransu tutuklandı. Fakat mesela bu suçlarda adı geçen hiç kimse yargıya gidip aklanmadı. Ve bu tutuklamalar Türkiye'de şu an hani 15 Temmuz sonrası işinden atılan insanlar tarafından bile dikkate alınmadı. Çünkü o zaman onlar da sistemin içerisindeydi. Maaşları vardı, makamları vardı. Ben mesela Yargıtay'daydım. Yani herkes gibi gazete haberlerinden görmedim, bizzat yaşadım bu durumları. Yargıtay'da o iki hakim, bu kişilerle, yani suçlanan kişilerle ilgili tahliye kararı veren iki hakim tutuklanmıştı. Metin Özçelik ve Mustafa Başar. Onlar yargılanırken 15 Temmuz sonrası görevden atılan yargıçların hiçbiri gelmiyordu. Ya da dört savcı yargılanırken, o 17 Aralık yolsuzluk soruşturmasını yürüten polisler yargılanırken, ama ne zaman sistem onları sistem dışına itti, onlar da konuşmaya başladılar. Şimdi Türkiye'de bir adaletsizlik ateşi vardı. Bu ateş kimin evine sıçradıysa ateşi fark etti. Fakat Türkiye'nin her tarafına yayıldı şu anda bu ateş ve adaletsizlik kuşattı yani ülkeyi.
So, you know, I just want to mention that, you know, these injustice, you know, unlawful, you know, actions of the regime has not just started with the July 15th coup attempt, you know. So as I mentioned, that I made news for a lot of, you know, on about a lot of files which are followed closely by the government, like the corruption of Lighthouse, you know, the NGO or unidentified murders against Kurdish businessmen. So after I made news about September, December 2013 corruption investigation, so the names of some ministers, you know, prominent ministers and the members of Erdogan family were included in this investigation. After a couple of weeks, I witnessed the arrest of two public prosecutors who revealed arms smuggling in Adana and two other public prosecutors who were responsible for them. In contrary with other people, I tried to reveal the unlawfulness treatments to public. I insisted talking about these issues everywhere I've been to. Before July 15, the coup attempt, a lot of people ignored these kinds of events, saying, let's sleep in dogs lie. So, you know, they, you know, preferred to stay, you know, hush and calm and, you know, didn't come out and say anything about it. They kept the silence with the sake of not losing their salaries and their positions. You know, whenever actually you know, trouble knocked on their doors and they lost their salaries, their living, livelihood, they start to talk about it. You know, one of the, you know, facts that actually people who had intervened, like the police officers, initially, or the prosecutors who had been arrested and later had been jailed, you know, the rest of an actually has not, you know, kept it still quiet. Even the judges who had later acquitted these, you know, prosecutors and the police officers, even they, for example, these judges, including the Mustafa Başar and the other one I just mentioned,
Metin Özçelik.
Metin Özçelik, yeah, Metin Özçelik. You know, and you know, then they start to actually talk about in these incidences, even the after July 15, the fire ring of the fire of injustice, which started with a sparkle, burnt the houses of a lot of people who were educated but kept it silent up to date.
Okay, and şimdi bu tarz aslında bu planlar iktidarın kendi planı değildi. İktidar o döneme kadar suç işleyen taraftaydı. Fakat bu tarz şeyler olmasını bekleyen derin devlet dediğimiz güçtü. Bunlar 15 Temmuz'da iktidarla birleşip 15 Temmuz'u insanları, yani bütün muhalifleri avlamak, fişledikleri insanları hapishanelere doldurmak için kullandılar. Şimdi Türkiye'de her ülkenin bir derin devleti var. Fakat bizim, yani Türkiye'nin derin devleti kendi halkını fişlemekle meşgul. Yani dinine, ırkına, ideolojisine, yaşam tarzına, cinsiyetine, her şeyine bakarak kendi halkını tek tipleştirme, bir mankurtlaştırma çalışması içerisinde ve insanları çok önceden fişlemiş ve bir gecede, yani 15 Temmuz'da yaklaşık 3000'e yakın hakim savcı bir gecede görevden alındı. Binlerce insan tutuklandı ve cezaevine konuldu. Yani bunun bir günde olması mümkün değildi ki 15 Temmuz bunun altyapısıydı, bunu yapmanın. Ve bugüne kadar ulaştı sonrasında.
So the fire which have been those who suffered from injustice start to scream. So I can briefly say that the justice was turned into ashes after that day. So the fire which have been looked for years by the deep state, now which was hindered behind the government for years, was finally broken out. This band, which blacklists or profiled MSL, their own people according to their ideology, race, lifestyle, or sex, encoding them as enemies, opposition, sent a lot of people into prison. More than 3,000 judges and public prosecutors were arrested at one night. These figure reached to 6,000 with those who fired from their jobs. Books were counted as a crime of material. Everyone who did not sit on the same table with the deep state was sent into prison.
Şimdi bu insanların cezaevine girmelerindeki sebep bir darbe yapmak değil. Çünkü kimse darbeye katılmadı. Yani bir öğretmen bir iktidarı nasıl devirebilir? Ya da bir gazeteci bir iktidarı nasıl devirebilir? Yani böyle bir güç zaten yok. Aptalca gerekçelerle insanları tutukladılar. Suç delili olarak kitapları gösterdiler. Ya da işte ne bileyim evlerinde diyelim ki cemaatçiler Risale okuyor. Risale bulduysa suç oldu. Fethullah Gülen kitabı suç oldu. Kitaplar suç unsuru ve şey oldu. Ya da işte bir bankaya para yatırmak gibi dandik, basit nedenler. Çünkü yani bir suç varsa ve bir ülkede bir iktidarı devirmekle itham ettiğiniz gruplarda buna yönelik bir suç bulursunuz. Yaşam tarzı suç sayıldı yani insanların. Ya da işte devletle masaya oturmayan Kürtleri topladılar. Bunlar arasına Demirtaş'ı da koyabiliriz. Figen Yüksekdağ'da bu tarz, yani derin devlette AKP iktidarının ortak düşmanları hapishaneyi doldurdu. Suçlular değil.
So, you know, I'm also add that even today reading a book, like, for example, written by Demirtaş, you know, leader of the Kurdish party, who's also under arrest now, is considered as a terror crime in Turkey. So people, you know, who were, you know, like, for example, journalists or those simple citizens, you know, being accused of actually toppling the regime or the ruling party. The accusations were so ridiculous. Even people who had the possession of just a simple book, like, for example, a book written by Said Nursi, is called, called the Risale, or the book written by Fethullah Gulen. Even the possession of having a book actually considered as a crime, or having deposited money to a bank. These are all considered as a crime against the ruling party or the regime, as if they are trying to topple the government. Everyone who had not sat down to the table with the government, who had not shared the same views as the government, or had been jailed. That included the Kurdish party's leader Demirtas or Figen Yüksek are in the same boat.
İşte devam edeyim siz şey kaldığınız yerde. Yani Süren'in haklı olduğuna, suçlu olduğuna değil, ne olup ne olmadığına bakıyor. Yani ideolojine, ırkına, cinsiyetine, ona göre bir hapishaneye girme şeyin potansiyelim var. Zaten şimdi iktidar ve bu derin devletin karşısında birisi, söylediğin her söz bir örgüte denk geliyor. Bunlar çünkü bir sürü örgüt yaratmışlar ve hapishaneye girmeme lüksün yok. Ya birinin propagandasını yapıyorsun diye suçlanıyorsun ya da bu sözü söylediğin için birindensin diye.
So put people, profile people and book people according to their ideology, according to their race, ethnic background, or their gender, and then they created these, terrorist organizations, so-called terrorist organizations, and they start to put people in jail. And it was so easy for them to put people in jail, because they'll look at their, whatever they did right, whatever they had said, and they'll put into, under a certain terrorist organization that they created, and they jailed them this way.
Mesela şu anda da Türkiye'de iktidar ve onun birleşenleri bir kitabın okunup okunmaması gerektiğini tartışıyor. Yani medeniyetin olmadığını bizzat yöneticilerden anlıyoruz. Yani Demirtaş'ın kitabını okusak mı okumasak mı bu bir terör faaliyeti. Yani bu kadar aptalca şeyler bir yani böyle övünme ya da onur gibi meydanlardan konuşuluyor ve bu bir karşılık buluyor.
So, it has got to a point that, the people in the power, they decided to, make conversations and, decisions, like even as little as to, reading a book written by, say, by Demirtas, who's a leader of a Kurdish party, whether if it's a crime or not, they even start to actually openly chant about it in the open to the public.
Şimdi Türkiye'de şöyle bir şey de var. Bunun dışında mesela uluslararası örgütlerin Türkiye'de birer başkanlıkları var. Mesela gazeteci örgütleri, PEN var, ne bileyim hepsinin Türkiye'de bir kurum yani temsilciliği var. Amnesty de dahil buna. Fakat ben bu kurumlar kendi lobilerine göre kişileri belirliyorlar. Onlar da Türkiye'deki bozuk sistemin içine girdiği için gerçek anlamıyla çalıştıklarını söyleyemeyiz. Ben 4 senedir buradayım. Daha önce Türkiye'de gelmeden de birçok kez yargılandı. Yargılandığım davalarda hiç kimse yoktu. Ben hep yalnızdım yani ne Türkiye içerisinden ne bu kurumlardan. Buraya geldiğimde de beni kimse aramadı. Eminim yani dışarıda olan ya da Türkiye'de hapishanede olan bu insanları da bunları aramıyorlar. Bunlar fonları alıyor, cebine dolduruyor. Amnesty de aynı. Belirlediği mağdurları anlatıyor. Yani bu kurumlar mesela ben Türkiye'deki PEN'den aranmadım ama Kanada'ya geldim. Kanada'daki PEN beni aradı. Bu kurumların da mesela bir fonksiyonu yok. Sistem kadar bu kurumlar da bozuk. En az iktidar kadar bunlar da kirli.
So there are certain institutions, international institutions, say for example journals. The the journalists associations or groups, even as far as the ones international ones, the ones had the branches and the representatives in Turkey. Like PEN is one of them. Even the institutions like say Amnesty International is one of them actually. So they have they do exist in Turkey. They have lobbies in Turkey. They do lobby in Turkey too. So these organizations are, I would say, passive or not reactive to anything. Like, for example, I was living in Turkey up until like 4 years ago, and I've been tried in courts for many times. And unfortunately, I was all alone without any of those, institution support. It looks like they do have funds, but they just pocket these funds and they don't make any, opposition or make any sound. Even after I came into this country, to Canada, they have not contacted me, including the PEN.
But, şey söyleyebilirsiniz, hani Kanada'daki PEN'in burada benimle irtibat kurduğunu, Türkiye'dekinin değil.
So the PEN in Canada have been in contact with me, but PEN in a branch, representative, branch in Turkey had not been in contact with me.
Şimdi Türkiye'de insanların kavgası kişilerle, mesela Tayyip Erdoğan'la kavga ediyor. Benim Tayyip Erdoğan ya da AKP iktidarı şununla bununla sorunum yok. Benim sorunum sistemle. Yani bu sistemden çıkarılanlar bugün bağırıyorlar. Eğer sistem onları tutsaydı belki bağırmayacaklar. Ama Türkiye'de gerçekten bir adalet sistemi çalışmıyor, demokrasi çalışmıyor. Ülke zaten ırkçı bir ülke. Yani özgürlüğü biliyor, karşılığını bilmiyor. Irkçılığın kötü bir şey olduğunu sadece biliyor, içini dolduramıyor. Demokrasiyi biliyor, anlamını yaşamamış, bilmiyor. İsveç değil çünkü. Geriye dönüyorsunuz derin devlette, Ergenekon, kumpas deniyor. Kardeşim sen İsveç ordusu musun yani? 10 senede bir darbe yapıyor. Bu 15 Temmuz nereden çıktı? Niye bunların planları gerçekleşti? Diğer taraftan mesela bu 15 Temmuz sonrası alınanlar, 15 Temmuz öncesinde başlayan bu süreçteki gerçekten 7-8 yıldır hapishanede olanların isimlerini anmıyorlar. Yakup Saygılı diyen duymadım ben. Özcan Şişman diyen, Aziz Takçı diyen, Metin Özçelik, Mustafa Başer diyen, Mehmet Baransu diyen, bir sürü gazeteci konuşuluyor, Mehmet Baransu konuşulmuyor. Bunun ahim dosyası bakılmadı. Ne bileyim, Türkiye'deki Anayasa Mahkemesi'ne başvurusuna bakılmaz. Bu insanlar 8 senedir orada, eşleri tutuklu, binlerce davalarla yüz göz oluyorlar ve yalnız kalıyorlar, isimleri anılmıyor.
So you know, like for example, the Tayyip Erdoğan is in power, AKP party, you know, Justice Party is in power. You know, I don't have like personal problem per se with them. You know, I have a problem with the broken system, you know, broken justice system. So, you know, people are already, and I would say the country is already racist in that sense. You know, they talk about freedom, but they don't live the freedom, or they don't want people to live the freedom. They talk about the justice, you know, equality, but they don't, you know, live on it. So these, you know, not you know, the things that, you know, the people talk about it after they got suffered after July 15th, but they don't talk about the people prior to July 15, a coup attempt, like who had been, you know, imprisoned for 7-8 years and they still keep in there. Like, for example, Yakup Saygılı and Mehmet Baransu, you know, who had been, you know, in jail, even as we speak, for the last 8 years. And yet they never talk about it. Even their wives had been jailed and they don't talk about these.
Mesela Türkiye'nin dışarısından Türkiye'ye baktığımda hani yalanlar ve gerçek anlamda sistemle savaşıp demokrasiyi talep eden insanlar göremiyorum. Ağlayan bir orduyla savaşa giremez. Eğer bir demokrasi talebimiz varsa bunu güçlü bir şekilde söylememiz lazım. Bir de Türkiye'de sorun şu, tamam devlet böyle kendi halkını düşman olarak kodlamış ve işletmediği bir sistem var. Suç örgütü gibi çalışıyor. Ama bu tarafa geçtiğinizde, halkın içine girdiğinizde halk diye bir şey yok Türkiye'de. Gruplar var. Bu gruplar birleşip bir halkı oluşturamıyor. Ve o yüzden de arz talep yerine gelmiyor. Yani kimse gerçek anlamda güçlü bir sesle söyleyemiyor. Sonra dışarıda, içeride kime dokunsam psikolojim bozuk diyor bunları yaşadığım için. Psikolojin normal zamanda zaten herkes normal insan olur. Bu zamanda psikolojin bozuk diye neyse o ortaya çıkıyor yani. Esasen kişinin kimliğini kriz anında anlarsın. Kimsenin psikolojisinin bozuk olduğunu düşünmüyorum. Normalde zaten hepimiz iyiyiz.
So, you know, as I said, you know, people are living these lives and they're in this broken system. You know, but we have to fight against this injustice. You know, there is a saying, you can't go to a war with the crying soldiers. So you have to be strong about this and strong against this broken system. You know, people, you know, are saying, you know, even after these, you know, what they had went through injustice, people, you know, continue saying, when I get in contact with them, they say, you know what, I have a broken psychology, I'm depressed and everything. But, you know, in a normal times, you know, everybody's normal. You know, what's important is actually being strong and at times like these and standing up. You know, there is no excuse just saying that actually I have a broken psychology and just stepping aside.
4 yıldır Kanada'da yaşıyorum. Burada dünyanın her yerinde insanlar var. Ne bileyim işte bazen yemek dağıtıyorum. Eritre'nin bile restoranı var. Sorun çıkmıyor çünkü burada bir hukuk sistemi var. Yani sorun insanlarda değil. Türkiye'ye baktığımız zaman yani şu konuşmayı dinleyenler mesela uluslararası örgütlerden ne kadar ciddi alacaklar bilmiyorum. Çünkü gerçekten samimi anlamda bir şeyler yapmak isteyen kişiler bu işi bireyselleştirmiş. Kurumların bir rolü yok. Bunu nereden anlıyoruz? AİHM Başkanı Türkiye'ye geliyor. Gidiyor, iktidar partisiyle görüşüyor. Anayasa Mahkemesi başkanıyla oturuyor, poz veriyor. O mahkemenin üyeleri hücrede tutuluyor 4 yıldır. Ben hayatımda bu hukukçular kadar onursuz insanlar görmedim. Özellikle bu AİHM'dekiler kadar. Kendi mesleklerine sahip çıkamayacak kadar alçak görüyorum bunları. Çok da net söyleyeyim. Çünkü yani bir mahkemeye gidiyorsun, o mahkemenin üyesi hücrede. 100 kilometre ilerinde 100 tane hakim, savcı, üst düzey yargıç hücrede tutuluyor. 16 kilometre ötende Sincan cezaevi var. Bilim adamı, akademisyen, gazeteci orada tutuklu. Sen gidiyorsun, ondan orada resim veriyorsun. Bir tane 4 yıldır bir dosyaya bakamıyor bunlar. Evrensel bir hukuk kuralı var. Senin gücün varsa ve bir şeyleri durdurmaya imkanın varsa bunu kullanmalısın. Gidip poz veriyorsun. Bunu bana mesela burada AİHM başkanıyla ilgili adil, onurlu, namuslu bir adam birisi diyebilir mi bu resmi veren? Ve bu adam da orada duruyor. Dolayısıyla Türkiye'deki olan olayların dışarıdan bitmesi mümkün değil.
So, you know, for example, you know, I've been living in this country, in Canada for about 4 years. You know, this is very diverse population. You know, sometimes I, you know, get to actually hand out food. You know, even as far as actually they have, even from countries like Eritrea, they have restaurants here. So, you know, I do know that, you know, there are people from an international community listening to this conference, but I don't know how sincere and serious they are, you know, because people are trying to do, as far as I see, on the personal level. And these institutions, I don't know how sincere they are and if they are doing anything and what they are doing. Well, I want to give an example. Like, for example, head of the European Court of Human Rights, you know, came to Turkey and went ahead and actually met with the, you know, Erdogan, and then continued to actually meeting with the chief of the public prosecutor's office of the country. You know, they handshake and they sit down, they talk, knowing the fact that the original, you know, members, ruling members and the head of the public prosecutor's office, the chief actually sitting currently in prison, and you know they talk, they chat, and they leave. So I'm not sure, you know, if their justice, their way of understanding of justice, is going to do anything.
Şimdi dünyada bu güne yani adliye muhabirliği yaptım. Hayatımın yarısını bu işte harcadım. Buraya da geldim. Ne bileyim, bir sürü yolda gördüm. Gördüğüm kadarıyla yani insanlarda, toplumda bireysel olarak ya da grupsal olarak bir sorun yok. Sorun siyasetçilerde, bu AİHM başkanı gibi gücü elinde tutan insanlarda. Çünkü dünyada savaşı bunlar çıkartıyor, devletlerin kasalarını bunlar soyuyor, uyuşturucu ticaretini bunlar yapıyor, sınırları bunlar koyuyor. Biz o sınırlardan atlamak zorunda kalıyoruz, kimimiz ölüyoruz. İşte ben mesela bu benim yolum dedim. Kendi çocuğumu götürmedim. Çünkü benim seçtiğim bir yerde, benim bile bilmediğim bir tehlikenin içine çocuğumu atamam yani. Ama bunu yapan insanlar da oldu ve onlar çocuklarını o nehirlerde bıraktılar. Baktığınız zaman bu lider denilen adamlar dünyayı mahvediyorlar. Ve o yüzden yani hiç kimseye ben liderim demiyorum. Hiçbirisinin liderliğini de kabul etmiyorum. Ama hani sorun, sürekli sorunlar konuşuluyor ve çözüm üretilmiyor. Güçlü bir ses vermemiz lazım bu yüzden. Gerçekten fark etmek lazım. Ağlamakla, sızlamakla bu iş olmaz yani.
You know, I worked, as you might not know, but I worked in, you know, courthouses, you know, as a crime reporter, as a reporter from the courthouses. You know, all these leaders, you know, massive, you know, they are the ones, unfortunately, like, for example, you know, going back to head of the European Human Rights, you know, court, you know, justice, you know, head, you know, these people are not, you know, creating any solution. These people are part of the problem. You know, they, because all these leaders, you know, they're the ones actually starting wars. They're actually in, you know, drug trafficking. So I don't find any of them sincere. You know, people had to flee, in their route, actually, for those, leaders who had created the borders, I had to cross through borders, and I chose not to bring my children, but some other people did choose to actually take their children with them in this journey that they had to, flee. And they had to leave their children in the rivers crossing these borders, meaning that they sacrificed their children, they died. I think what we, I'm not a leader, and I'm not following any leader. But we have to be strong, and we cannot be just being depressed and crying about these things. We have to be strong and fighting.
Teşekkür ederim. Thank you. Arzu, I was going to ask a lot of questions, but you answered all of them. So we know each other. That's why I guess we started knowing each other. So I was going to ask, what do you think that we should do in terms of solidarity, in terms of strength and etc.? But you answered that. So my question would be that, what are you planning to do in the short term and in the long term in your life as a journalist, as an outspoken, great, brave woman to champion the human rights issues?
Ben artık yani gazetecilik yapmayı çok düşünmüyorum. Yani bir, belki de bu benim en son yayınım. Çünkü çıkmayı da çok düşünmüyorum. Ben daha çok kitap yazıp kendi halimde yaşamak istiyorum.
And everybody loves your stories. I have to admit that again, I'm trying to follow the comments on YouTube and you have a fan club, Arzu. You have to see all of them.
Biliyorum, ben hiç hissetmiyorum onu ama olsun.
I said to Dr. Gergerlioğlu, I see that people are praying for you, are, you know, applauding for you, but I see that a fan club because of your bravery, your strength, your being outspokenness, everything. So good luck with your studies. Good luck.
Son bir şey söyleyeyim.
Okay.
Mesela hani doğudaki çocuklar polis yanlışlıkla ateş açıyor, ölüyor. İşte batıdaki çocuklar sınırdan kaçmaya çalışıyor, ölüyor. Ya da cezaevinde işkencelerle işte sandalye olayı gibi ölüyor. Yani buradan izleyenler genelde dindar insanlar. İmanla korku yan yana gelecek iki şey değil. İmanla şikayet de yan yana gelecek iki şey değil. Ben bakıyorum bunlar benden daha çok şikayet ediyor. Ya diyorum ben din eğitimi almadım, bunlar böyle. Yani aslında onlarda bonus da var. Arkada kelebek de var. Bizde o da yok.
Arzu, we know that you have a great faith. We speak to each other, you know, very frequently. Okay, I am also proud of your bravery as well as your faith in the, you know, goodness of the betterment of the world. So thank you for joining us today.
You're very welcome. Teşekkürler.
Sure. And now we're going on with Mr. Bilici, today's fourth panelist, who is a Turkish newspaper executive in exile in the United States, following recent political turmoil and government oppression of the media in Turkey. Before leaving the country, Bilici served as editor-in-chief of the newspaper Zaman, the largest daily newspaper in Turkey once. He also was the chief executive officer of its English language version, today's Zaman. And Bilici also served as a general director of Cihan News Agency and editor of Aksiyon Weekly Magazine. What a journalist background, Mr. Bilici. And he's an expert on Turkish politics and is widely sought as a speaker on the ongoing political crisis in Turkey. Bilici is editor of the book Why Turkey, which combines different perspectives on Turkey-EU relations. As a close witness to the silencing of the media, Mr. Bilici has a lot to share with us today. Let's listen to him.
Merhaba, hello everyone. It is so stressful to talk about anything these days about Turkey. Indeed, a lot of problems. It's not just limited to Turkey. I mean, you look at the Hong Kong, you look at the Uyghurs in China. I mean, a lot of problems. It's not good time for democracy around the world, and of course, very bad times for Turkey. In terms of democracy. So as you rightly said, I am an exiled journalist living in America for last 4 years, since 2016. I was the last editor-in-chief of Zaman Daily, which was the largest circulated newspaper of Turkey. So, I mean, Turkish people understand the situation and my position and the, what was Zaman standing for. But for international audience who do not know much about Turkey or me about Zaman, I say that example, I mean, to understand, to help them understanding gravity of the problem that we are talking or I am representing. So consider that Le Monde of France or New York Times of America has been shut down by their governments and its editor had to leave the country. So this is my situation. And of course, the persecution or the silencing of journalists is not limited to my newspaper. There are today more than 100 journalists behind bars. And in last 3 years, more than 200 media outlets were shut down. And these are representing different perspectives of Turkish society. Some of them are liberal, some of them are Kurdish, some of them are Alawite, some of them are leftists. But the common thing about them is they are critical of the government of Erdogan, the Erdogan's rule and his oppression and corruption. So my story is not important because of me, but because it represents an important picture of what's going on in Turkey. So we were preparing to celebrate our 30th year as a newspaper, and we were supporting Turkey to be a real democracy and join European Union, for instance, was one of the very important editorial priorities that we had. So we were trying to bring different voices in Turkish society to speak up their minds without any limitations. And with that, in a normal day, you could see in our newspaper a journalist, a columnist from a Kurdish background, from a leftist background, from a liberal background, having their opinions on the same topic. So this was a very big richness for Turkey, for intellectual life of the country. But since 2013, when this great corruption scandal was revealed, we started to be very critical of the Erdogan government, and that created the rift, the tension or the conflict between the government and our media. And all of our, and most of our columnists, reporters, staff struggled from 2013 until 2016, March. Despite all the oppression, all the pressure, all the court cases, all the threats and everything, I mean, the cancellation of the press cards was just one of the minor issues, the tax inspection, I mean, a lot of ways of pressure Erdogan tried. But I mean, I'm proud that all our staff, all our journalists working with our newspaper stood very strong and powerful until the day on March 4th, 2016, when as a last resort, Erdogan got a decision, a court decision from a kangaroo court, indeed, not a real court, to appoint trustees to our board. And they came, indeed, they did not come in a civilized way. I mean, if you Google, anyone can Google Zaman raid Turkey, you would see that this is an occupation by a brutal police force against journalists who has nothing to do other than writing their opinions, their news, and respecting rule of law, supporting democracy, all those values. So after that terrible occupation, in 24 hours, they changed Zaman from a critical newspaper into a mouthpiece. And 4 months, they continued this with this new editorial policy. They fired me, of course, the first day. And then they hired another journalist to lead the newspaper. And with that, they started to have a kind of propaganda brochure for 4 months until the July 15th coup attempt. So when coup happened, the newspaper and its editorial policy was designed and defined and shaped by the government of Erdogan, but they accused our newspaper for supporting the coup, which was in their control. So with this ridiculous accusation, they raided the houses of our columnists, reporters, and they arrested whoever they found. So since then, I mean, this was the 27th of July, maybe 10 days after the coup attempt, this failed coup attempt. Even they raided my home, but I already I left at the end of the March that year. So they were not able to find me, but there is an arrest warrant against me. So I can't go back to Turkey. But my story, I mean, this is tragic though, but I sometimes ashamed of sharing my story, looking and remembering those who had to be facing prison terms or had to be facing torture. So this is unbelievable things are happening in last 5 years. Some of them are very well presented by all of the speakers, by professor, by Faruk Ergeloğlu, by my colleague Arzu. So I don't like to go into all details, but this is a story of a country that is that was hopeful, was giving hope to be an example of Muslim democracy, and turning into an autocracy in 4 or 5 years. And now we are talking about torture, jailing not just journalists, but the women, babies, judges, even the member of Constitutional Court. So, I mean, the case is so much tragic. But why, the question is, why we came to that point? That's very important. In my view, there is a very important reason for this. It is the a wrong diagnosis of the problem played a very crucial role. You know, if you like to solve a problem, you need to have a healthy, a good, a correct diagnosis of the problem, first of all. So when this, the oppression or the drift of Turkish government from democracy started in, especially in 2013, in 2013, with the Gezi protests in the summer of 2013, and then with the corruption scandal in December of the same year, many people in Turkey, including the observers, international observers, defined the problem as a struggle, a power struggle between the Gulen movement, the Fethullah Gulen movement or Hizmet movement, and AKP Erdogan. So that definition was translated into international platforms. So you could see the same description in New York Times, in Washington Post, in Le Monde, in Guardian, etc. So the first, that wrong definition of the problem alienated a lot of people in Turkey who were supposed to come together against the drift from democracy, against the authoritarian policies, against the corruption. So for a couple of years, that helped the Erdogan government to disunite people in Turkey, the Kurds, Alawites, leftist people, some liberals. They thought that this is an internal fight between two powerful forces, social forces, and this will not touch to their homes or their freedoms. So since it was a wrong description and definition, it did not stop there. So yes, the 80% or 90% of persecution or the human rights violations today in Turkey are against the Hizmet movement people. giving a figure may not be correct, but a majority of at least 1 million people were investigated. More than 300,000 people were arrested. If you calculate, a lot of them are belonging to Hizmet movement or affiliated with Fethullah Gülen's ideas. But this is not limited to that. I mean, when you go and look at the people in jail today, you could see Osman Kavala, for instance, is in jail. He's a businessman. He's a human rights advocate. But he has nothing to do with Gülen and Hizmet. And Selahattin Demirtaş today, as the leader of the third biggest opposition party, in jail, but he has nothing to do with Gülen and Hizmet movement. So with that wrong description and definition, democracy unfortunately destroyed. And this is a very grave problem that unfortunately still continues. Just yesterday, I saw a news about there were more than 90 arrests. These are almost routine now. They are people arrested, doctors, the medical professionals, and they are accused of belonging or affiliated to the Hizmet movement. But one of the news portals, which claims itself as independent or liberal, whatever, but they were using the same description as this so-called infamous FETÖ, you know, the Fethullah Gülen terrorist organization, to describe those people who are doctors or who are teachers or academics, who has nothing to do with any crime, let alone attempting to violence, has nothing to do with coup, whatever. So that short-sightedness was a very important problem in my view. And the second problem is international dimension. You know, when you look at Turkey, you see this human rights violations and the destruction of democracy is not new, as underlined by previous speakers. So just to remember, you know, we had one party rule since the beginning of the Republic, which lasted more than 25 years. And in those years, as today, as Ali Ünal, Mustafa Ünal, a conservative religious people in jail, together with a leftist liberal Ahmet Altan, Selahattin Demirtaş. In the early years of Republic, Nazım Hikmet was persecuted, and also Bediüzzaman Said Nursi was persecuted. They left. Nazım Hikmet died in exile. Sabahattin Ali died on the way to exile. And Bediüzzaman Said Nursi, although they had different views and perspectives, spent all his life, at least 35 years of his life, either in jail or in exile within a country. And even he was not left in peace in his grave when he passed away. But, we should also remember that the persecution against the Armenians, against the Jews, against the Kurds. So this, what we are witnessing in Turkey is not new. It's not new. It is occurring, reoccurring. And this brings me to the point that I like to underline. Why we are not learning? That is the biggest problem that still we are facing. So in my view, we don't know democracy. Yes, in theory, we know. I studied political science. Of course, everyone knows what's democracy, but we did not digest it. So we assume democracy as a tool to bring us to power and then to control, to suppress whoever others or other point of views. And this is not limited to just Erdogan government. So this has been the case from the Union and Progress Party, at the last years of Ottoman Empire, you know, the İttihatçılar were very much freedom fighters. A lot of them were in exile. We are talking about 100 years ago. They were in exile. They were defending more rights, constitutional limitations. They were against Sultan's oppression. But when they had the chance to be in power, they made worse oppression. They destroyed a lot of rights of freedoms, a lot of human rights violations. And the Kemalists were also very progressive. They were saying that we will be bringing civilized levels of democracy to Turkey. But what they did when they were in power, for 25 years, they had one party rule. And their ideology was the source of 5 military interventions. And even they came to, I mean, fight with everyone, with not just what, not just with the Muslim or religiously oriented people, but with the leftists, with the, I mean, with the even nationalists, with a lot of people. So when Democrat Party came against Republican Party, the Kemalists, they had the same problems. At the last years, they were arresting journalists, they were investigating journalists for their critical positions. And now we are seeing the same scenario repeating, that now Islamists are coming to power, who were defending rule of law, democracy, and they were champions of press freedom. Now they destroyed Turkey, even worse than the Kemalists. So today, just to give you, give our listeners a comparative perspective, on the real coup that happened in 1980, do you remember how many academics were expelled from university? Just 120. This is a real full-fledged coup, a successful quote-unquote coup. 120. So what is the number of academics who were expelled or jailed or killed after this unsuccessful failed coup attempt? It is over 7,000. So in those years that we had the oppression, you know, I say we never had a full-fledged democracy. But comparatively, we are living darkest times. Because, for instance, Bediüzzaman and his followers and his students were in jail, but their wives, their kids were not touched. But now the Turkish jails has more than 10,000 women, more than 700 babies. So that, I mean, yes, Turkey was not democracy ever, but today, even compared to a lot of oppressive times, it is really very dark. And looking from an international perspective, why Europe, why America is not helping Turkey? Because they did not help Turkish democracy when in the 90s, Turkish Kurdish villages were destroyed. Unfortunately, this repeats and without we learning to digest democracy and defend democracy for everyone, unfortunately, that story will continue with oppression of other people in the future.
So regarding what you told about the components of democracy, we all know that freedom of expression and speech has never been enjoyed truly, fully in Turkey. But when I go to conferences, international conferences, people are asking me, what do I think about the very first step? And I always say that if the media is silenced, then the rest just can come very easily, the collapse of rule of law or the other types of oppression. What do you think about the silencing of the media in the first hand in Turkey?
Yeah, I think in every case, in any authoritarian country, they attack first to media because this is the way to control flow of information, to shape public opinion, people's minds. That's so crucial. So because of that, all authoritarian governments or leaders had a policy to silence media, especially critical voices. And that happened in Turkish, in Erdogan's case as well. So there are two things happening at the same time. While destroying the critical voices, the critical media, they create a propagandist media. So today, as I said, 200 critical media outlets were shut down. One of them is my newspaper, the news agency Cihan or Samanyolu or Bugün. A lot of media outlets were platforms of democracy, and they were very important platforms for opposition, but they are not existing now. We are using social media, YouTube channels, etc. as a replacement. But on the other hand, also they create a propagandist, a mouthpiece media. And that is very crucial for their continuation of power. And 95% of Turkish media is not media today. It's a propaganda booklets or a propaganda mechanism that is another obstacle in front of changing Turkey or bringing Turkey back to democracy, because that shapes people's minds. So that media calls me terrorist, 95%. And they repeat every day. And they call every of the members of that panel maybe as terrorists. And that, unfortunately, a lot of people believe in this propaganda. And so it is very crucial. Two things are so crucial for any democracy: the press freedom and the independence of judiciary. If you have any danger in two of them, you should expect that the bad days are coming. So first journalists are jailed, and then teachers, and then academics, and then business people, and then politicians. So this is how it proceeds.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Bilici, for your remarks about the freedom of expression and what happens when the media is silenced that you talked about. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Now our next and fifth guest in Freedom Convention 2020, also the Freedom of Speech and Expression panel, Ahmet Nesin. He's an exiled journalist like the other journalists in today's panel, living in Germany. This is not the first time he had to leave Turkey, actually. He went to England and Switzerland to study following the March 12th coup in 1971. After he returned to Turkey, he started working as a core and martial law correspondent for Günaydın newspaper. And he has been writing articles in the Artı Gerçek internet media, of which he is also the founder since 2016. Additionally, Nesin is hosting and producing programs on Artı TV. He also produces news programs on his YouTube channel. Mr. Nesin is going to share his own experiences in freedom of speech and expression in Turkey.
Merhaba, teşekkür ederim. Önce Bilici'nin konuşmasında şöyle bir şey geçti. Nasıl bu hale geldik diye. Size biraz önce gelen bir haberi okuyacağım kısaca. 10 yaşındaki AK'nin velayeti 18 sayfalık ATK raporuna rağmen 4 yıldır kendisine sistematik cinsel istismarda bulunan baba ŞK'ye verildi. Baba hakim. Mesleği hakimlik. 4 yıldır istismar eden çocuğu babaya vesayet olarak boşanmada vesayet olarak babaya veriyorlar. Şimdi nasıl bu hale geldik ki? Çok fazla anlatmaya gerek yok sanıyorum. Bu ta Cumhuriyet'in kuruluşunda, esasında Osmanlı'dan ama bizi ilgilendiren Cumhuriyet'in kuruluşundan anlatmak lazım. Türkiye'nin aydınları nasıl aydınlar, Arzu haklı olarak şikayet etti, nasıl aydınlar onu anlatmak istiyorum ve ilginç bir olayla anlatmak istiyorum. Dünyada bilmiyorum ama Türkçe'de tuvaletin helanın çok versiyonu var. Sözcük anlamında çok versiyonu var. İşte ayak yolu var, memişhane, aklınıza ne geliyorsa var. Hepsinin bir anlamı var, neden söylendiğinin bir anlamı var ama 100 numaranın hiçbir anlamı yok. 100 numara nereden geliyor? İşte Osmanlı'nın son dönemindeki aydınlar Fransa'ya, Almanya'ya, Avrupa'ya gidiyorlar. Orada aydın oluyorlar. Sözüm onu, aydın oluyorlar. Fransa'nın da bilhassa Paris'inde bir derdi var. Bilhassa Eyfel'le beraber işte çok ciddi turist sayısı artıyor. Turist sayısı artınca yollara tuvalet yapmak zorundalar. Öyle bir durum icap ediyor. Tuvaletlere ufak binalar yapıyorlar şey yollara ufak binalar yapıyorlar. Bilhassa turistlerin gittikleri yere. Fakat belediye bir takım yani medeniyetin kurallarını öğrendiği için binada numara olması lazım. İşte evinizin numarası 12, 21, ne bileyim 38. O da bir bina olduğu için onun da bir numarası olması lazım. Çünkü bunu belediye yapıyor. Fakat numara vermesi için içerisinde insanın oturması gerekiyor. Tuvalette de insan oturamayacağı, yani yatılı olarak kalamayacağına bir çözüm arıyorlar. Çözüm sonuçta şöyle bir şey çıkıyor. Sanlimero dediğimiz bir yazı yazıyorlar. Sanlimero S-A-N-S olarak yazdığımız zaman numarasız anlamına geliyor. Yazdıkları da bu. C-E-N-T diye yazdığınız zaman yazılış farklı ama okunuş aynı. Sanlimero 100 numara. Rakam olarak 100 C-E-N-T. Bunu sözlü olarak bildiriyor ve Türkiye'de Avrupalılaşmak adına tuvalete 100 numara denmeye başlıyor. İşte medeniyet böyle gelişiyor. İşte bizim batılılaşmamız böyle bir şey. O yüzden nasıl bu hale geldik? İki örnekle anlatmaya çalışın, devam edeceğim.
Okay. So there are a couple of interesting things about the civilization that I want to give an example actually. This is a bit of a like a history lesson I might say actually. You know, there are certain things, certain ways to say what, like for example, in certain places people calls toilet as the bathroom, and some calls a toilet, some calls a water closet. There's of course different ways of saying it in Turkish as well. There is in this one particular one in Turkey they called bathroom or the toilet or the water closet WC. It's called by the number. It's called 100. So how do they come up with this, name 100? Named for a toilet or a bathroom. People in the times of the Ottomans actually, they did travel to France. These people later on called intellectuals. People. France, they didn't realize that, France had this Eiffel Tower, and Eiffel Tower, they start to actually draw a lot of tourists. So in these tourists, what they need bathrooms. So, and for to erect a building, they would need, they have to put a number on that building. For example, for a building to have a number, they have to have people living in it. So they could put 17, they could put 25. Well, what would they actually number these, buildings, to as far as for the city management wise? Sanlimero is the name they came up with. If they were to write S-A-N-A-S, so it would have a different meaning than if they were to write it as C-E-N-T. So if they were to read it in French, they will like sound the same, but it'll be different. Like, for example, C-E-N-T would be 100, like as a number. And that's how they come about, naming the, put on another name actually for bathroom rooms in Turkey after these people came back from their travel from Europe, and named another name they put for toilet or bathroom as 100. So, and I'll give another example, a couple other examples about the civilization, how the civilizations in the world developed. Or go ahead.
Şimdi bugün demokrasi adına, demokrasi için yaptığımız bu programları düşünüyorum da sanıyorum iki önemli soru var birbirimize sormamız ve devletin bunu bir şekilde yanıtlaması gereken. Bunlardan birisi bize okullarda öğretilen cumhuriyeti kim kurdu? Bunun cevabı çok basit ve belli. Atatürk arkadaşları kurdu. İkinci soru, ama hiç sorulmayan soru, çünkü cevabı olmayan bir soru, demokrasiyi kim getirdi? Biz demokrasiyi geri almaya çalışma mücadelesindeyiz ama bana göre bu demokrasi Türkiye'ye hiç gelmedi. Yani 1960 darbesi öncesi demokrasi vardı dersek yanlış düşünürüz. Adnan Menderes ve arkadaşlarının asılmasına sonuna kadar karşıyım. İdama karşıyım. O ayrı bir şey. Ama Adnan Menderes hükümetinin, Demokrat Parti hükümetinin demokrat olduğunu söyleyemeyiz. Tek parti hükümetinin de demokrat olduğunu söyleyemeyiz. Ondan sonrakilerini de hiç söyleyemeyiz. Buna Demirel, herkes dahil. Bülent Ecevit ve Milli Selamet Partisi Erbakan dahil. Demek ki o zaman demokrasi yerine bize cumhuriyet öğretilmiş. Bu bilinçli olarak öğretilmiş. Çünkü o yüzden de demokrasi kurtaralım yürüyüşü Türkiye'de hiç olmamıştır. Belli bir sosyalist kesim haricinde hep cumhuriyeti kurtaralım mitingleri olmuştur. Bu da ciddi bir problem yaratmıştır. Şimdi evet, siz çevirin isterseniz.
So, you know, there's just two questions that, you know, coming up in my mind that I believe that had to be answered by the government. You know, one of the first questions which actually did teach us in schools, you know, who did establish the republic? You know, we all know the, you know, answer to this question. The republic has been established by Atatürk and his friends. And second question is, who did establish or bring in the democracy? You know, it feels like there is no answer to that question. It feels like it had never came to Turkey. Like 1960s military coup, you know, so where members of, you know, certain political party whose leader is Adnan Menderes and his friends have been hung and killed. So, which I'm against the capital punishment. And I don't agree with this decision. And even before, can we say there was democracy in Turkey like before 1960? I can't say because it was a single party rule, you know, country. It was Turkey. Even after then, I cannot say it was still was a democracy. Even at the time of the Demirel, which was a president, Bülent Ecevit, no, prime minister. My apologies, and then Bülent Ecevit, and even Erbakan, I might say. So even for the meetings, large meetings, or you know, I would say protests and get-togethers, you know, in the name of republic, especially the socialists, you know, will actually do, you know, arrange these protests and meetings, but they will not arrange it in the name of or saving the democracy, but they will actually organize this as saving the republic.
Şimdi demokrasiyi geçemememizin nedenleri var tabii. Yani geçememenin nedeni burada Cumhuriyet'i kuran Atatürk'e de İsmet Paşa değil. Cumhuriyet kurulduğu tarihte ki kadınların okuma yazma oranı %2, erkeklerin %5,5 bütün nüfusun. Böyle bir okuma yazma oranıyla bir ülkede demokrasi getirmek mümkün değil. O yüzden biz neyi demokrasi zannetmişiz? İşte Atatürk'ün harfleri değiştirmesini. Kime harf değiştiriyor? Okuma yazması olmayan bir topluma harf değiştiriyor. Kimin işte şapka devrimini yapıyor? Ne takarsa taksın hiçbir tanesinin umurunda olmayacağı bir şey. Çünkü bir bilinci yok. Eğitimsiz bir toplumun böyle bir bilinci yok. Kurtuluş Savaşı zaten halkın ayaklanıp da yaptığı bir şey değil. Osmanlı'ya karşı halk ayaklanmamış. Kurtuluş Savaşı yanlıştır anlamına gelmesin bu. Çünkü böyle anlattığımı söyleyecekler olacak. Ben önceden gardımı alayım. Ama halkın ayaklanması, halk Osmanlı'ya karşı bir şikayeti yok. Çünkü şikayet etmek için hep söylediğim gibi işte bir eğitim gerekiyor. Bu eğitimin olmadığı bir toplumda hiçbir şeyin halkın talebiyle, yani devrimin nasıl olur? Devrim halkın isteğiyle olur. Halkın ayaklanmasıyla olur. İşte kadınlara oy hakkı. %2,5 okuma yazması olan kadına oy hakkı vermek demokrasiyi getirir mi? Mümkün değil. Evet.
So, you know, let's look at to why the democracy has not come to Turkey. You know, we cannot blame it on the Atatürk or İsmet İnönü. You know, at the time when they established the republic, the literacy level of the woman was 2%, and for men it was only 5.5%. So, you know, we think of, you know, bringing in the democracy, or the history of bringing in the democracy was the, you know, when Atatürk actually changed the alphabet, alphabet revolution, I would say, or the revolution of, you know, of hat. And, you know, people didn't care what, you know, whether if they did, they wear the hat, that they didn't wear the hat, because they didn't have this consciousness or understanding of what it meant or what it brought to them, because they were illiterate. For example, are these illiterate people were the ones actually organized and started the independence war? No, I doubt so. So in the same thing, actually, if the people were uneducated or illiterate, actually, so they cannot put out even a proper complaint or a cry out. You know, so it cannot be done by, you know, this cannot be actually done by the request of the public, because they are not educated, and therefore, you know, the democracy might not be actually claimed by uneducated or illiterate people. Dominus.
Şimdi, yine aynı döneme geçtiğimizde Atatürk'ün çok önemli olduğu söylenen bir cümlesi var. Nedir o? Feriz Çakmak ve Kazım Karabekir ve onun gibi komutanlara şöyle söylüyor Atatürk. Eğer siyaset yapmak istiyorsanız askeri elbiselerinizi çıkartın gelin diyor. Şimdi bu çok doğru bir cümle. Çok demokratik bir cümle. Ama kim söylerse demokratik bir cümle, ben söylersem demokratik bir cümle. Neden ben söylersem demokratik bir cümle ya da neden Atatürk'ün söylediği esasında doğru değil? Çünkü bir subayın, şöyle mareşal olmuş, general olmuş bir subayın ta ortaokuldan itibaren, ilkokuldan sonra aldığı bir askeri eğitim var. Bir generalin diyelim ki 40 yıl, 30 yıl, 36 yıl bir askeri aldığı bir eğitim var ve o mantıkla hareket ediyor. Bir sivil gibi düşünme olasılığı yok. Çünkü savaş olma ihtimaline karşı ülkesini savunmak adına öldürmenin planlarıyla büyümüş bir insan düşünün. O askeri kafa elbiseyi çıkarttığın zaman sivil kafa olmuyor. Belki de Kurtuluş Savaşı'ndan sonra en büyük yanlış Cumhuriyet Halk Partisi'ni iki önemli askerin kurmuş olması. Ve Cumhuriyet Halk Partisi'nin bugüne kadar hiçbir genel başkanının biz Sosyal Demokrat Partiyiz artık diyememesinin nedeni buradan başlıyor. O yüzden milliyetçi tavır alması böyle... Bir takım durumlarda işte Suriye'de buna benzer durumlarda milliyetçi tavır almasının nedeni ilk doktrininin asker tarafından verilmiş ve kurulmuş olmasından kaynaklanıyor. Böyle bir durumda demokrasiyi Atatürk'ün okuma yazma bilmeyen bir topluma getirmesi de mümkün değil.
So there's this famous word, you know, was said by great Atatürk, and this words actually was forwarded and actually said to two generals in Marshall, I would say. Fevzi Çakmak is one of them, Kazım Karabekir was the second one. You know, he quoted, if you want to be in the politics, you have to take off your military suit and then come. So, you know, if this word to be said by me as a civilian, you know, that would have been a true statement, a sincere statement. But, you know, I wouldn't believe it was so much of a correct statement or the place of Atatürk to say that. You know, a marshal or a general at the top level, you know, was a soldier, officer who had been educated in military academy. So had been educated at some certain stretches as 30 years, 36 years or 40 years. So these people have only one goal in their mind. If there were to be any conflict, if they, you know, if it push comes to shovel, and they have to actually protect their country, fight for a country, they have only one thing in their mind: to kill. So to remove a soldier hat does not make them immediately a civilian or help them to think like a civilian. And the party that was created by Atatürk, which is CHP, you know, People's, you know, Party, to People's Republic's Party, actually. So they, in a sense, has I feel like, you know, they have never were able to like say that, yes, we are social democrats. They could never say it because what they had in their, I would say, genes is actually made them in a way be and act and, you know, make a statement as if they are like a nationalist, like, and, you know, because of the first doctrine they got from Atatürk, you know, and this behavior we have seen in the operation against Syria.
So, Mr. Nesin, just I have a question. You are talking about the components of democracy, the democracy discourse, and the actors who carry out the democratic, you know, developments, who should not. I want to take this argument into the people of Turkey, not the actors, the rulers, the administrators. Since we are exceeding the time, I have to, you know, go ahead. What's the perception of human rights and democracy, these issues in Turkey? How do you read, I mean, the society's approach to these issues, to these arguments in terms of freedom of expression and speech?
Şimdi bu noktada sizlere işte şunu sormak istiyorum. Siz demokrasinin elementleriyle ilgili olaraktan ögelerini söylüyorsunuz. Bunları anlatıyorsunuz. Yani bunun aktörleri kimlerdi? Bunların yöneticileri kimlerdi? Bunlardan söylüyorsun. Ben biraz daha farklı bir noktaya parmak basmak istiyorum. Halktan söz etmek istiyorum. Yani halk sizce demokrasiye nasıl yaklaşıyor? Bu aktörlerden ve yöneticilerden başka halk sizce konuşma özgürlüğüne, insan haklarına nasıl yaklaşıyor? Halkımız nasıl yaklaşıyor bireysel olarak?
Şimdi halkın çok ciddi bir şekilde yaklaşabilmesi için bunu bilmesi gerekiyor. Tam da esasında oradan Müslümanlardan bahsedecektim bu aynı düzlem içerisinde. Bilmesi gerekiyor derken neyi kastediyorum? İşte Türkiye'nin %99'u Müslümandır dediğimiz ya da denilen bir ülke. Şimdi aynı sayı değil ama %90 diyelim. Cumhuriyet kurulana kadar inandığı İslamiyet'i kitaptan Türkçe okumamış bir toplumdan bahsediyoruz. Şimdi demokrasiyi bilmiyor ama inandığı şeyi de bilmiyor çünkü Türkçesini okumamış. Okuması yasaklanmış. Nedenlerini tartışmak istemiyorum. Şimdi 1960 darbesinden sonra bir takım kitaplar Türkiye'de basılmasına izin verilmiş. 1960'a kadar yabancı dil haricinde Türkiye'de sosyalist kitapları da, bilimsel kitapları da okuyamamışız. O yüzden bu halkın demokrasiyi isteyip istemediğini kestirmek zor. Demokrasiyi isteyen bir toplum 1960 darbesinde idam kararı verildiğinde sokaklara dökülür ve o idamı durdururdu. Ondan sonrasını anlatmaya gerek yok zaten. Birinci darbeyi siz halk olarak sokağa çıkıp durdurursanız, parti olarak her şeye hayır derseniz, hangi parti olursa olsun, o zaman o ülkenin bir daha darbe yapma olasılığı olmaz. Ben 63 yaşındayım. Yapılmış bütün darbeleri yaşadım. Yapılamamışların da hepsini yaşadım. Ben darbe öncesi gözaltına tutuklandığımda Şebnem Korucu'yla beraber ve Erol Önderoğlu'yla beraber çıktığımda bir hesap ettim. Aynı suçtan babam 64 yıl önce tutuklanmış. Ahmet Altan şu anda hapiste. Aynı suçtan babası 50 yıl önce hapse girmişti. Şimdi o yüzden bu toplum %1'lerde kitap okuma alışkanlığı olan bir toplumun böyle bir şeyi istemesi olasılığı çok fazla yok. Bunun çevirisi son bir şey söyleyeceğim, sonra bitireceğim zaten.
So, yeah, well, the regular public, you know, they need to know. They need to know. So is the Muslims has to know as well. You know, so they call, they used to call, or they claim that, you know, the population of this country is 99% Muslim. You know, I don't believe so nowadays. I believe it's only at most at 90%. So for example, if it was come to like 1960s, like, you know, there was a coup, and you know, so after, before this coup, like, here's the Muslim for many years, including the before 1960 coup and during the time of the Ottomans, they could not read about their religion in Turkish language. But I don't know, I don't want to, you know, speculate on the reasons or give the reasons and talk about it, but they could not read about their, learn about their, you know, religion, Islam, in the language of Turkish. After the 1960 coup, you know, they were, you know, they did allow to, you know, issue some books on it and on socialism, even science, which was prohibited part of it actually prior to that date. So we have to see if the Hulk, if the people, the nation actually, you know, of the people, you know, they, do they want the democracy, or what do they need to want the democracy? So I'm at the age of 63 right now, and I have witnessed and lived through at my age almost all the coups. So when the time came, this most recent coup, when they apprehended and arrested Sebnem Korucu and Erol Öndoğlu, so at the same time, I was arrested as well. And I'm looking back about 64 years, and my father was accused and apprehended and arrested for the same crimes that they're accusing me of doing. And let me give another example from the journalist Ahmet Altan, who's also, you know, been jailed, arrested. His father was accused of exact same crimes that he had allegedly committed 50 years ago. So we have this population of, you know, about 1% of the population had their reading habits. So they, all the books I read, there's only 1%. So it's very difficult to, you know, to, you know, mention that these people are asking for democracy. Dominus.
Ahmet Bey, Mr. Nesil, I'm so sorry. Can you just wrap it up, because we have just 10 minutes to finish the program and we have a last speaker, but okay, not the least. Thank you.
Ben Cumhuriyet'in çok geniş kapsamlı Cumhuriyet'in demişim işte, Türkiye'nin alışkanlığı bu. Demokrasinin çok geniş kapsamlı bir şey olduğuna inanmıyorum. Faşizmi, ırkçılığı, totalitarizmi savunan bir partinin olmaması gerektiğine inanıyorum. Hani hep şey diyorlar ya, herkes her fikrini söylesin. Hayır, yok böyle bir şey. Faşizmin propagandası özgürlük içerisine giremez. Basın özgürlüğü ve düşünce özgürlüğüne giremez. Anlatacağım bir şey vardı ama 10 dakika kaldıysa kısa geçiyorum. Recep Tayyip Erdoğan hapse girdiğinden bir gün önce İnsan Hakları Derneği bunun düşünce özgürlüğüne karşı bir haksızlık olduğunu için bir basın toplantısı yapmıştı. Beni de çağırmıştı. Herkes Erdoğan'ı savunurken ben o gün demiştim ki eğer bir şeriat isteniyorsa şiir diye her şey edebiyat sayılıp düşünce özgürlüğüne giremez. O yüzden de o dönemde söylediğimi bugün hala söylüyorum. O yüzden de 2003'te Erdoğan gelince Türkiye'nin ve dünyanın başına bir bela geldi. Siz de farkında değilsiniz. Türkiye'de değil deyip Fransa'ya iltica etmiştim.
So, you know, there are a couple of things I want to mention. You know, the, you know, unfortunately, what we have is actually fascism. What we have is racism. What we have is a totalitarian regime. Like sports also have it. And this is what this party is, actually ruling party is. So when it comes to, you know, freedom of speech and freedom of expression, so if we were to actually talking about, like, say, for example, or writing about fascism, you know, I don't believe there should be any freedom of expressing the fascistic or totalitarian views. I don't believe that's freedom. You know, and when Recep Tayyip Erdoğan had, was like, you know, jailed, and the day before he was actually sent to jail. So there was this, you know, meeting with the human rights activists, and they were all against him actually going to jail. And I was not one of them actually, because, you know, so because he did read the poem, and the poem was actually promoting Sharia. So one had to ask, you know, are you reading this to promote the Sharia, or, you know, the purpose of that actually? Anyway, so I believe when in 2003, when Recep Tayyip Erdoğan came into power, you know, I knew that it was going to be a disaster, not just for Turkey. It was going to be a disaster for the world, and I proved to be right. And back then, I did move to France just for this reason.
Oops, sorry, I was muted. Thanks, Mr. Nissen, for joining us today. And now we have our last but not the least guest, Hakan Yeşilova. Mr. Yeşilova is the editor of the Fountain magazine. As an editor, translator, and writer, Yeşilova has contributed to a number of publications on Islam and interfaith dialogue, including A Tribute to the Prophet Muhammad, The Sacred Trust Toward a Global Civilization of Love and Tolerance, and Humanity of Muhammad. Welcome, Hakan Yeşilova. We're ready to hear from you about the destruction of knowledge. How come knowledge is destroyed, Mr. Yeşilova?
Well, thank you, Mrs. Gerdap, for this invitation. I'm very honored to be on this panel with veteran journalists and scholars. Of course, as a Turk, I'm very saddened by what's happening in Turkey, but I'm proud of you, Advocates of Silence Turkey. Even the name of your foundation actually speaks so much about the current state of affairs in our country. But of course, as a Turk, we're not very proud of the situation there. Well, by first gradually buying or indirectly controlling newspapers and TV networks, then by scaring others with political pressure and deprivation of financial resources, right? Then, of course, unlawfully taking them over by assigning trustees, and finally shutting them all down, arresting their staff. The Turkish regime, of course, has silenced all critical voices. And even though they may not be directly opposed or critically engaged with the government, like the publishing house I used to work for, but it was one of the biggest publishing houses in Turkey, Kaynak, and we did not publish any political content, let alone even current affairs, but it was mostly, as my little bio showed, mostly books on religion, interfaith dialogue, and cultural affairs. But sadly, since we don't have much time, I'm passing very quickly. The very sad thing about Turkey, let me show how the Time magazine listed last week that Turkey actually lists the top. Let me see where this is. All right. I hope you're seeing my slideshow here. Turkey, Time magazine listed Turkey as the top urgent case, citing Ahmet Altan. But of course, we're all very sad for Altan, and we really hope he will be released very soon. But what is really missing in this photograph is books like these and the authors of these publications. I hope the image is visible there. These are all our publications. All of them are either prayer books, the saintly figures of Islamic history, and great figures like Bediüzzaman, who wrote all the time on Quranic tafsir. So this is a terrorist operation, and what the police has found as evidence for terrorism. I think all the Muslims around the world who are now praising the Turkish government really need to look into this image and think say second time. There are other cases. All of these books are on Islam and religion, nothing related with political affairs. And what ended up with after the coup attempt was raiding of bookstores, which were actually selling these copies of the Holy Quran, tafsir commentaries, hadith books by Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And as you can see, they're on top of desks and throwing away books like the Quran copies. I don't know, the world history has a lot of incidents like these, but probably what happened after the fake coup attempt in July 2016 is only comparable to what the Mongolian invasion did in Baghdad and in other centers of learning in Central Asia, where the rivers were actually were flowing, the story goes, with ink and blood. Perhaps millions of copies of books were destroyed. I once tried to help a colleague, an editor from Turkey, as an interpreter for his asylum interview. And he was one of the editors who edited books on Quran and Islam. And he said how he had to destroy these copies after the coup attempt, for they were considered as evidence for terrorism charges, that he put them all in the bathtub, watered them first, and then tore them apart one by one. And as he was telling these, he was crying, I was crying, and this young officer lady was handing out as a handkerchiefs. Well, I wanted to give you also the example of Ali Ünal. We were working for the same company with him, and these are some of the books he translated and edited and actually compiled. He's an author of perhaps 30, 40 books, a volume which we cannot even imagine. I actually brought some here so that you can actually see the size of the books that he contributed to Islamic studies. He's now in jail. He was sentenced to 19 years for some of the columns he wrote for Zaman newspapers, leaving behind this sick girl, daughter of him, who's very much dependent of him. I knew because his office was very close to our office building, his home, and we saw how she was so dependent on him. Again, we need to realize, as other speakers mentioned very briefly, this is a pattern happening throughout the history of Turkish Republic. So it's not unique only to this government, but what they did best was to really integrate their religious hypocrisy to the already present powers of the deep state so that they could actually reap off from the resources of the government and state. So I want you to look at these images of ladies. Never in the history of secular Turkey, this many amount of practicing Muslims, devout women and mothers were jailed and oppressed. Again, I'm not singling out this government for all these oppressions, for there's a history of oppression in the Republic. And all these headscarfed women were already being persecuted and undermined in previous regime, the ancien regime of the Turkish Republic. But now the figures have gone up so high, tens of thousands of those now jailed with their babies. As you can see, this poor child there entering a prison with her mother. So, well, as I know, we only have 2 minutes left. I'll give my respects to the, of course, next panel. But let me just briefly say that this is not the a blame on Islam per se. This is an opportunist government working like a cartel with and no ashamed of posing with mafia leaders and trying to take their share from the resources of the state. This has nothing to do with the Islamic faith, and they have no intention really to represent it. They would do so with any other ideology as long as it benefited their own services. So my magazine, the magazine I work for, this is on science and cultural affairs. When you open it, you would find articles on how plants do not develop cancer. How do ants know trigonometry? But this is banned in Turkey. There's no more words. Let me finish it here. Maybe one thing I could also share, two copies of The Fountain. This is published in America, the same issue, as you can read the title, Muslims Must Combat the Extremist Cancer. But when our company was taken over in Turkey, it was removed by the trustee, simply because it was authored by Fethullah Gulen. I think this is also very telling how the Turkish government approaches extremists as opposed to how those people they consider and label as terrorists approach to extremism. Let me finish here. And again, it's been a pleasure being on this panel. If there are any questions you would like me to address, I'm here for you.
Thank you. Could you please stop sharing your screen so all the speakers could be seen? Yeah. And I had actually lots of questions, but because of the timing, we had really amazing topics, hot topics, because freedom of speech, freedom of expression has been the first step to silence people. So it was really hot today to discuss these issues. Thank you for joining us today. And a special, shout out to our translator today, Mr. Saymaz. And thank you for fostering human rights, championing human rights in your lives, in all the platforms that you are trying to do. And our second panel will be in half an hour. Please don't go anywhere. We are going to be here in half an hour. Thank you again for all your efforts and for joining us today.
Thank you very much.